Obviously, I know Councilmember Moreno is here, but I know a number of the district council members are going to have a lot of specific questions about their districts with regards to number one. Councilmember Brissett.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and good morning to colleagues and to members of the public in the audience. The paramount issue right now is getting the trash collected. People are fed up to above their ears, and we want to know what the next steps are to get all routes collected for whatever sector, whatever region you're in of the city. It's important that this public health crisis is resolved once and for all. This public health emergency, while we are still in a pandemic, is of utmost urgency to myself and to my colleagues, and we are going to do everything possible to get to a solution. So I am ready to hear from the administration. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Are there any other colleagues who want to say anything before we begin? Yeah, okay, let's get started. Then I would ask the administration to come down, and I guess for me, I want to start with and hear from my colleagues, just starting with how many households, and I'm just going to name some neighborhoods that haven't seen collections since before Ida, Bayou St. John, Country Club Gardens, Gentilly, New Orleans East since before Ida hit, how many households and where we are and what's going on with that. So I welcome the administration to start answering these questions, and then of course we're going to have questions about where the schedules are, where is that list published, who can answer those questions. But I'd like to, I think, kind of get started at the top. Yes, Councilmember Wynn.
Yes, so Joe, I also wanted to add the lower nine, Holy Cross, were not picked up prior to Hurricane Ida as well.
Yeah.
And also please add Marigny and Bywater and St. Rock. Also, some areas not picked up since before Ida.
Yeah,
And council member, we have the contractors that you'll be able to direct those questions directly to as we begin the premise and the discussion of the presentation. So we specifically brought the vendors and the contractors to address those specific questions, as well as the administration to talk about some of the highlighted items you articulated. So if you give us a second to set up, we can jump to that, that information. In the formality of a normal proceeding, what we do want this to ensure for the public's sake that we have the ability to address these questions directly and in the comprehensive nature that is ultimately necessary.
Yeah, I know we got the presentation at 9:30 this morning, and so we've been asking these questions for weeks now. So
Council, I just don't want to interrupt, but I know that you've been part of all the mayoral briefings and when we have all these discussions and whatnot, and I'll appreciate our ability to answer these questions directly, but in no way can it be construed that this information hasn't been provided at some level at different periods of time. And at 9:30 in the morning, the presentation was continuing to be worked on. But for the benefit of the city and the administration, I think it's going to be vital for us to not have a discourse in this conversation, because ultimately what matters is the citizens we're representing and we're serving, and we want to come to the solutions, and we feel like we have a both short-term and a long-term plan and strategy to address that. So if it's the will of the council, without jumping into a crossfire, I think it'd be helpful for letting us address the presentation and dive into those questions. And
the will of the council is to have our questions answered first, unless anybody disagrees with that. Does anybody here disagree with having a presentation, or do you want to hear the answers to the questions about why our neighborhoods haven't been picked up and how many those are? Okay, so the will of the council is to know, number one, how many households, whether it's the Lower Nine, Marigny, Bayou St. John, Gentilly, New Orleans East, 7th Ward, have not seen collections since before Ida. How many households?
Chairman Brissett, Chairman Geruso, with all due respect, I think it's important for us to be able to explain a little background, because it's not just the council we're presenting to, but also the public, and then dive into those specific questions. We have a lot of things happening. We have Operation Mardi Gras as we speak. There's a lot of attention that has to be paid to the operational side of that. And I appreciate the direct questions, but the administration is comfortable and trying to create the presentation, as every other one of these procedures has involved, then we will dive into the question. This is absolutely the normalcy that we have been provided the council, a presentation that takes deliberate work, specific. Many of the questions could be answered in the presentation, and then we can dive into the questions. To get into this early crossfire, I'm not sure helps the overall goal that we're trying to accomplish. It almost feels like we're working against each other when we invite you to the table to work with us.
But we're not in normal times. That's the bottom line, is we're not in normal times. And I've been inundated with emails that are going unanswered. I've been asking questions for weeks that have gone unanswered. And, you know, frankly, we were ready to issue subpoenas to questions that we're not getting the answers to. If that's what we need to do, then that's what we will do.
If I may, Councilman.
Well, but hang on, Mr. Green. I mean, I'm asking a very simple question. It is a very simple question. What is the number of households that haven't been collected since the storm hit? That's all we're asking. I mean, there is a number that is that answer. We will let you get to the other pieces. We understand that there are issues about labor shortages. We understand that there are issues with trying to collect everything post-storm. We get all that. But I'm just trying to get to what is the answer to our question.
Let me take a stab at this, Councilman. And I want to provide some context a little bit, if I can. And I'm going to give Jimmy just a moment to sit down and join us. And I appreciate you being here, Jimmy. I understand that you have questions that have gone unanswered. So have we. And we've been managing a continuous array of crises for quite a while. And this, I would tell the council, is not an easy one to solve. We have sat before you for Hard Rock, for multiple storms, for COVID. This is the first time where we cannot throw money at a problem to solve this issue quickly. We've tried that. We've been on the phone with national contractors. We did an emergency procurement. We had for the service area 2, which is New Orleans East, Lower 9, Gentilly, and Lakeview. We had no responsive bidders at this moment.
And Marion and Bob.
That is a showing the dramatic national crisis for CDL garbage truck drivers in this country. It was exacerbated by COVID. It was a problem pre-Hurricane Ida. We don't deny that at all. And Hurricane Ida has brought this issue to a head. This morning, beginning at about 7:30, I spent time with somewhere around 70 city employees, deploying them throughout this city in different crews to pick up trash for using vehicles that are not generally designed for that, taking them away from their core vital work that our city employees have been doing since Hurricane Ida entered the Gulf of Mexico. Our folks are working incredibly hard to solve this problem. We are working incredibly hard to get additional contracted resources to this city to solve the problem. To not talk about why we're sitting here and just get into which neighborhood didn't get their trash picked up, I can tell you I can't answer the question. I don't know which neighborhood specifically, how many households have not gotten their trash picked up since Hurricane Ida. I can tell you a lot of them. I drive around the city and there's trash on the streets. It's unacceptable. If it were as easy to simply turn to the two people on my right and say, go on your merry way, we need another contractor, we would do that. But that is not the situation that we are in right now. We are putting all of the resources out into our city to bring the trash off of the streets of your neighborhoods. And I think we're in, at least in service area 2, in every one of your council districts right now. Our vehicles are out there, our people are doing it, police escorts are there to keep them safe. These are unusual times. We had a near category 5 hurricane hit this city, and the fact that we're discussing trash on the street, I find that very comforting, that there's power in people's homes, that we have safe drinking water, that our drainage system is functioning, that the levee system worked, and we do not have water in front of our homes and flooding our homes. I really appreciate the opportunity to discuss this. But I would ask respectfully if we can talk through the why, what we're doing about it, and what we're going to continue doing about it. That's all I'm asking. And thank you, Jimmy, and thank you, Deidre, for being here, not only to represent your companies, but to answer more questions in detail should the council have them. Thank you.
And Mr. Green, we were here earlier in the summer, and I understand what you said about the labor issues that's countrywide. What about focus on, from the city side, the contractual issue with pay? You pay people more, you invest from the city side in the contract. What is the, that is a viable option. You pay people more, they come to the work and provide the service. What is the city doing?
Councilman, I think you're asking an incredibly good question, but if I can put your question in context, these contracts were bid before any of us got here as part of the Cantrell administration. As you know, the city does, you know, lowest price, whatever. I will readily admit and acknowledge that post-COVID, our labor is legitimately in a position where they ought to be paid more. I think that's obvious. I would frankly, though, direct your question to the contractor sitting on my right. Thank you.
And Mr. Green, I understand that, and thank you for your honesty. But of course, my colleague to my right is an attorney. That's what's called contract amendments. And I know that the previous administration, the Landry administration, confected those contracts. But we're talking about trying to get to a solution with this issue.
So I want to make sure what you're suggesting the solution is that Metro at this point, and Jimmy, interrupt me at any time, please. Metro at this point is not able to collect trash, is unable to implement the contract that they currently have for the city, and your recommendation is to give Metro more money. I want to make sure that that's the line of questioning that I'm asking, because here's what I would say, Councilman. I would say that our citizens are so burnt out at this point over the ineffective trash collection that if for us to just pour money into our existing bidder, into our existing contractors, I would like to really re-explore this issue from a much more higher level, global perspective. Do we rebid the entire thing? Could we bring elements in-house? I think what you're seeing right now is a moment in time where we as a city government are responsibly stepping up, acknowledging this problem, a confluence of many crises, and we have to deal with it.
Thank you. I wanted to get your response, CAO, from the budgetary perspective.
I think that to address, I believe what was your direct question and follow down the track, Deputy CAO Ramsey Green articulated, is that to throw money at an existing contract to try to gain more drivers, hoppers, operators, etc., is the wrong path to take right now. There is absolutely, and I think the mayor articulated yesterday in the press conference, a vital reorganization that we have to evaluate as we rebid the contracts. And that's an absolute necessity based on the current performance that we've seen over the course of the last several months. That's a long-term solution. Right now, that doesn't take the trash off the streets in front of residents' house. So that is what we are ultimately focused on right now. How do we address the direct issue that we're having right now? Do I agree that more money is probably necessary for the rebidding of contracts? Yes, absolutely. Do I think that maybe it should be in two zones? No, not necessarily. Maybe it should be broken up into more. Maybe it should be broken up into one. I think there's a lot of due diligence necessary in the rebidding of this contract and how we are formulating the algorithms that go into the cost effectiveness of it. But once again, that's running parallel. But right now, the priority that we're trying to address is to get the trash off the streets in front of residents' lives, because this problem only gets worse the longer it goes, and it turns into more and more of a public health issue. And so that's what our focus and our goals in this last week are dedicated to. Tangentially, though, however, there has to be a long-term solution, and that is directly to what your question is, a reevaluation of how we're paying this for this contract. Look, there's even some discussions, internal, external. There's a lot of different venues we have to really aggressively challenge and look at. And despite, the contract does not end, if I'm not mistaken, to 2024. So there has to, we're not even finished with this contract. So this would be a mid course correction that we're trying to articulate and come to remedy with. So I think I've elaborated enough on that.
So, yeah, of course, we were here in July, and we are trying to get to a solution for the problems that we face as a city for our citizens. And we don't want to be here again next month in November. So all I'm saying is it's time to, it's of urgency to get the problem resolved.
I just want to, I'm not trying to over explain the complexity of this. If there was a simple solution, as Ramsey said, we would have done it immediately. We fire our contractors. We have no one to pick up trash.
Right.
We don't have an alternative. It's not, you don't like Sprint, so you go to Verizon. We don't have another option to go to right now. We have, and we saw that when we did the emergency contract. There was no limitations on money for our emergency contract.
None whatsoever.
None.
Nationally.
And we got a local and then someone that didn't have drivers, essentially. This is not a money problem that we're trying to fix.
And it wasn't a money problem. I'm sorry, Gilbert. It wasn't a money problem before Ida. This is a driver issue. And Jimmy, again, help me out, or Deidre.
Yeah.
This is a driver issue that you're seeing in national circumstances. The state of Massachusetts just activated its National Guard to drive school buses. This is a national crisis that has been brought to a head by a combination of the pandemic and now locally Hurricane Ida. We will get through this. We absolutely will. We have multiple ways to resolve this issue, which is in part because we've heard from you and your residents, our mayor's constituents, who are also yours, about the trash in the streets. We started at 7 a.m. this morning in putting all of the city resources, the airport, the sewage and water board, as many vehicles out there as possible, when we realized yesterday that Service Area 2's emergency contract was in all likelihood going to be labeled non-responsive.
I just want to make sure I understand. The administration has not only put out for bid, but contacted the top five producers.
Yes.
Hang on, let me get the question out. Has contacted the top five producers, and none of them can do a thing? Not one thing. No matter how much money we spend, they can't provide a service.
It's excellent. Sir. If I can, Councilman, I think it's a great question. When we put the procurement out, it was put on LinkedIn. We extended it 3 days. This is an emergency. So it's an emergency procurement. We notified everyone. I have to trust our processes to a degree, but our procurement is going on LinkedIn and some of the social media that a lot of these folks follow. I believe procurement made calls when we saw that the procurement didn't generate the number of bidders that you would hope, which we were concerned about. And once that, we call it in procurement, the cone of silence, once that period was closed, we started calling a couple of national bidders and we said, what's going on? And the answers were, it wasn't a question of money. It was a question of availability in this moment in time. And I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, I have to take your word for it, but I just find it hard to believe, and you're saying it, so I hope that's the case, because I just find it hard to believe money usually solves a lot of problems. And I know you're saying labor shortage exists, but a company like Waste Management is huge, right? I mean, they can't do a thing. They can't.
We spent, I want to say, hours in conversations. I could be, it could be more in that regard, because I know Matt had addressed that, and the answer was no.
No,
it was complete no. So any support to try to get potential national help would be actively. I mean, we've instigated our IGR team to have DC contact some of these national providers, but under the circumstance, we have been receiving no's.
Okay.
And any support you can get to a yes, we're open to that opportunity, because it is not a resource problem at the current moment.
And good morning, members of the council.
Wait, Councilmember. We got some council members. Sorry, okay. Mr. Woods, but Councilmember Palmer Moreno, then Wynn.
Thank you. I just want to, Ramsey, I totally appreciate your frustration, and I also appreciate how passionate you are about how hard the men and women of the city of New Orleans have been working. And I think we all agree with that. And you know, I've been incredibly supportive and impressed with
you. Absolutely have. Thank you.
And so I honestly don't want this, like Mr. Montano said, like, this is not an adverse reaction to the city and the men and women. My district is very interesting in that all three trash contractors operate in my district. There's only one trash contractor that we're having significant problems with, and that's Metro. And if you look at the 311 calls, right, that have happened, all the top 10 neighborhoods are in Metro's service area. So, and we were here in July, which was before COVID. So the issues we're talking about, perhaps, yes, Ida exacerbated, but we were all aware of them prior to Ida, right? So, and I do appreciate if we have an issue with drivers right now, and I do appreciate that that's because a lot of emergency contracts have been activated all over the region because of Ida, right? And so they're being deployed everywhere. But this issue we anticipated because of the ineffectuality of Metro. We're not having those problems with Richards. Yes, I have a few concerns with Richards that comes about, but we all know we marked that up to Ida, right? And they're taken care of. So I think we're all here to figure out, again, this council's been very proactive in trying to respond to the constituency, as has the administration, but there is an abject failure right now in one of the providers. And so I think we need to figure out how we're going to move forward in doing that, whether or not there's been a breach of contract, whether or not we need to start looking at this, and how we're going to supplement in order to get rid of this problem, because it is a health issue. Look, I applaud that the administration is going out and picking up trash, and then we have city employees that have already been working time and a half again and again and again, and now we're asking them again to go out and put themselves in quite frankly, unhealthy situations. That's a whole nother issue that we can talk about. They've already been in unhealthy situations, and we're asking them again because we have a provider that's been ineffectual. So I just want to be clear. The data shows this is not a problem throughout the city.
Your data is correct.
Yes.
And we know that.
Okay. So,
yes.
So let's not just make this as an Ida problem. This is a contractual problem that we're having with one of the providers. Either it's all on the provider, or it's also on the issue of the city not holding the provider accountable over time, right? So that's where I think we all want to go right now.
Sure. Let me try to take a stab at that, and then I'll pass it down the table. I don't disagree with anything you just articulated at all. I don't disagree on the contractual failings in some aspects. You know, I'll defer to our legal team to make that more specific as it relates to what we have been provided and what we had received. I go back to the time where we sat at this same table and we were trying to do everything we can to help Metro succeed in regards to their overall all need, and we gave them time and we gave them deadlines, and we were trying to solve the issue. Now we are in a different place at this point. I agree that was a problem then, and it's perpetuated into more of a problem now. As far as the liquidated damages, the penalties, and all of the things of the like, that is not anything that we have forgotten, right? I mean, that is absolutely important and vital for us to ensure that we have that ability and the plan to move forward in that ability. But once again, I'm trying to bifurcate that piece and then right now picking the trash off the table. And that's not, they're not mutually exclusive by any means. So in no way should the council, the public, or anybody not feel like we're going to hold feet to the fire. But patience is important to address the problem we currently have. And this is something that we are absolutely going to be exploring and moving toward in due diligence related to holding people's feet to the fire for what a service the public, the city pays for that we do not receive, and then moving forward for the long-term solution on how we're going to address and fix the overall contractual complications that we have moving forward with whatever new provider that we have in whatever time period seems to be most beneficial for the labor and, of course, the outcome of the delivery. Ramsey, I think you wanted to...
I was just going to add one thing, Councilwoman. Ida, I think, pushed it over the edge. We were at the edge, but the labor shortage was there well before Ida. I really would respectfully allow Mr. Woods to talk about Metro. I think you asked very direct and legitimate questions, but I do want you to know one thing. Pre-Ida, we had a debris contract, a pre-storm. That work is going very well. in a hurricane, we have to be very conscious of the difference between debris and garbage. I know it's incredibly odd for people to try and understand that, but I know you know that. And
let's be clear. I think the people know that. I'm not getting complaints
about debris.
They understand you had to clear the roadways first.
Right.
They understand where they have to put it. And this is a drill that the city is aware
yes.
of, right? We're getting complaints about the garbage bags, the household garbage.
I just want to clarify one distinction, though, because I think you alluded to what could we have done pre-IDA. For household trash, that is a city function. And that, even in a disaster, it is a city function as it was pre. What we have now is a combination of a labor shortage and a dramatic increase of household waste, garbage, that we are talking to FEMA about saying, look, I know this is unprecedented, right? Because FEMA doesn't generally pay for household garbage. But that debris is going well. That we talked to the debris contractor about, can you add on this household garbage? And they said no. I mean, it was for the exact same reasons that we're describing.
And let's be clear. I absolutely think there's validity, and I'm very pleased that the administration's going after FEMA funds, right?
Absolutely.
We're talking about
storms
where 100% of the people are in the city of New Orleans. So we're talking about 100% of the refrigerators, 100% of that waste that is now going out. We all here appreciate that. We all here understand that one route is now taking 3 to 4 times the amount to clean it up because of the amount of the waste and the heaviness of the waste. But again, this is not happening to the degree all over the city. It's happening in one service provider. So, you know, yes, there has been some hiccups in other parts with other service providers, but it's being fixed, right? And the people see that it's being taken care of. So, again, no, I absolutely want Mr. Woods to speak about this and figure out how we can solve the problem, because that's why, quite frankly, we're all here. And, again, it has elevated to the point of a health crisis. It's not like the debris. If it was just the debris, that's not going to perpetuate a health crisis. What's going to perpetuate a health crisis is rotting food, right, and people not having to walk around it, children not being able to be in the streets. That's what we're seeing. And trust me, I've been in these neighborhoods every day, my district council members as well. We see it very intimately. And it is a crisis, and the debris is not causing the crisis.
Thank you. Councilmember Moreno.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I really appreciate, you know, you all launching. Is it called Operation Mardi Gras?
We're still working on that, Councilwoman.
Still working on the name?
It was the working title was Operation Mardi Gras. We're calling it Operation Mardi Gras Clean Sweep, I think.
Okay. But whatever the name may be.
City employees going out there and doing this work.
There you go. I appreciate the effort here, but I think we need to be honest with the fact that we know that this is not a sustainable model, that this is certainly not a long-term solution. Where I'm concerned is I'm not sure how we ever catch up. So that we have to do some things that are immediate and drastic. So if we take a look back at what happened after Hurricane Katrina, when we did have a lot of household waste out in the streets, what was created in some commercial and industrial sites were these temporary transfer stations. Any possibility of creating some type of temporary transfer station, potentially, in the Area 2 portion of the city, so that the routes aren't so long and so that it's not these long trips to the landfill that are killing more time and trucks can get back out on the street faster and faster. I know that, you know, DEQ has some regulations around this, you know, making sure that there's no runoff and it must be on concrete and things like that. But, I mean, we have to start thinking outside of the box and you know, potentially start putting in these temporary potential transfer stations.
If I can, Councilwoman, you're bringing up exactly a great point. And we are doing it, I can assure you of that. I was on the phone personally myself 2 days ago with Secretary Chuck Brown from the Department of Environmental Quality.
I was on with him last night.
He gave us a waiver on a vegetative debris transfer site. You are describing one of the critical fulcrums of solving this problem. I believe that Operation Mardi Gras Clean Sweep is a week to two week of an operation. That is my hope. Truthfully, I mean, I don't even know how to make more clear. Could be a little more. Hopefully, it's a little less. those are the options that we are looking at immediately to help remedy this growing crisis.
And can I just buttress that sure. same topic? Part of the equation for the long-term solution is setting up whomever the contractor is to succeed. Mm-hmm. You know, the hour drive back and forth to right. River Birch is unsustainable for such a large geographical area. I mean, if we could cut that time by a third, by half, by, you know, whatever that percentage is, by locating it, that is the way you correctly organize a sanitation route without having that back and forth. So that could double the force multiplier opportunity for those. So that is both a short and a long-term issue that we are currently working on, and we hope to have more success in that in the next, probably the next week.
I think the other thing, too, is in the New Orleans East area in particular, there are companies that have the automated trash, I don't know what they're called, trash trucks, that from what I understand, they would be able to do pickups on our current cans through New Orleans East, which I think if there was a possibility to bring in some of those companies to the East, it could very much help out
sure.
the contractor there.
And, so
if you add that with transfer stations.
Right, mechanicalizing the process in the last city, everything was mechanicalized. It's very unique. We have such a labor need here. I understand the specificities of the narrow streets that we have to deal with, but we do it in the French Quarter at different levels. I mean, there is history. The business model, the mechanicalization of how this is deployed, the central nature of how the transfer stations work, the convenience center opportunities that the public have, all of these have to be part of that future opportunity for the long-term success. But that's also not withholding this parallel track for the short-term success that we also have
to gain as well. But I do think that could be part of the short-term success. I do think that, you know, trying to go out and really attract some of those companies that could add to Mr. Wood's service, I think would be important. I just think we have to take some drastic steps. I mean, if not, we are going to be stuck in this emergency forever. We're never going to catch up. And I, like I said, I really appreciate Operation Mardi Gras, Ramsey. I mean, you had to get out there, and it's a temporary solution, and I get it, and I appreciate it. But we have to do something super drastic right now, and I think it's the potential of these temporary transfer stations and trying to come up with companies who can come in here and do the job quick.
Councilwoman, if I can, I completely agree with you. There is no more drastic a step for us to do than what we're doing right now in taking people away from filling potholes, from cleaning catch basins, and putting them on picking up trash. You're going to see neutral ground grass grow a little bit longer than normally because they're out picking up trash. We have police officers escorting these crews. We are doing this because precisely we do not underestimate the crisis that this is. We hear it. I know you all hear it. Councilman DeRusso inundates me with emails, which I appreciate, Councilman. I do. I see them. I read every single one of them. We are well aware of what this crisis is, and we are looking at every single option. I will say this. If there is a firm that you are aware of that has these assets and the people to operate them, that's the critical thing right now. There are assets. There may not be people to operate them. Please let us know. That is what we're working on.
And I just want to highlight what the mayor said yesterday, and I think it's important, is that we take responsibility for this future solution, and we take responsibility for where we are now. The causes could be whatever they were, but it's important as a city and administration that we are taking responsibility and both for the solution and the future of it. So we're not trying to skirt by that, by our conversations or this dialogue, by any means or nature. This is the city's responsibility to ensure that residents have their trash picked up. And we're doing everything we can, both in the short and long term, to ensure that is addressed. Part of that does involve the necessity and the reliance that we have on some of the vendors and the contractors, and making sure that that is being held feet to the fire in that regard as well.
Yeah, things just can't continue being the same.
They won't.
They just can't.
They won't.
We will fail. We will absolutely fail.
That's our
they
biggest
continue being
fear.
The same.
3 months from now, we're in the same situation.
Same situation. So it's time to think outside the box, make some significant, drastic changes, because that's the only way that things will get better when it comes to the trash in the city.
Thank you,
Mr. Chair.
I respectfully, I've got 70 people outside doing an operation we put together very rapidly. I have to excuse myself. I'm sorry. I wanted to be here for the opening, if that's possible. I have a lot. I'm dealing with some stuff here in the field.
Yeah, and that's up to the chairs to go. But I do want to underscore that you're taking people away from cleaning catch drains during hurricane season. And let me be clear, you have to do it because this is a health emergency, but I think the reason I'm bringing that up is it underscores taking resources that also keep the city safe.
Yes.
And that's untenable.
Which is why I'm hoping this is a 1 to 2 week operation,
right,
as we explore precisely what Councilwoman Moreno is articulating and Councilman Geruso about national contractors, local transfer stations, and hoping that the folks to my right add to their battery of operations to improve this.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
For your service.
I know Council Member Wynn wants to jump in.
Yeah.
And also, as part of this, obviously, wages has to be part of the discussion, too. And I think that will be part of the questions we have as well. I mean,
sure.
So for...
Not to interrupt, but I just wanted to make sure that Ramsey is excused. I will stay here as per the charter. The CAO is required to maintain dialogue with the council, and I'll be able to address and represent the city and the administration moving forward, but he does have to be out maintaining our operation Mardi Gras. So with your pleasure, I will remain. Ramsey did have to depart.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Councilmember Geruso. Good morning to all, and thank you so much for being here with us. And just to add into the conversation, and I want to go back just a little bit, because I know that Metro Sanitations were before the council during COVID-19, and I know that there was some discussion or concerns and looking at the contract, if our contract are actually being paid correctly. I know we talked about pay. I know we talked about if you pay people right, they're going to come to the job, and I think that's going to help with the shortage. But are we paying our contractor the right way? If I remember correctly, the conversation was around the fact that Metro believes that they are servicing close to 70,000 household units in Region 2. And they're only getting reimbursed for up to, 66,000 household units. So that's a huge gap of reimbursement if you want contractor to pay people right. So where are we at on that discussion?
Chairman's, I think Ramsey answered that question earlier. To throw more money at a contract right now without making some significant structural changes to the overall viability and the competitive nature that we are absolutely having to pivot from would be unwise at this current point. I don't believe that the plan is to amend current contracts to throw more money at them, but instead to readdress the structural issues that we have currently ongoing with those specific contracts.
And I get that, Gilbert, but if you pay the contractor correctly so they could pay their people right, where people, and I think we saw that with COVID-19, where people underpay, people were not paying correctly. And then when that issue rises, a lot of businesses started paying people right so they can show up for work. And so...
So, yeah, and I don't want to mean to cut you off, but I'll try to say it a different way. So when they entered into a contract, right, they, prior to this administration, they submitted their bid. We took the lowest bid. That's required by law for us to accept the lowest bid. To amend the contract and not put it out for competitive bid and adding resources to that contract could significantly negatively impact the city. So because it is a contractual legal obligation where they have a dollar amount and they have a service that they have to provide, that is what they're bounded by. What I think you're suggesting is let's put more money into that specific contract without opening it up for other changes, just monetarily putting it in there. And what I'm saying from the administration perspective, that would be unwise without having some of the specific structural changes that we articulated, and then also having a competitive bid process, as everyone on the table has asked ardently, why don't we have more national responses? Why don't we have more national opportunities of that nature? So that is why, to your direct question, we have not just thrown more money in through an amendment process on their current contract, simply put.
Yeah, so Gilbert, I hear what you're saying, but we also have local people that are looking for work as well. And so if our contractors are paid correctly to provide the service, they could actually hire more people locally.
I think we're just going, Mr. Chair. I think we're just going in.
So maybe you could answer, ask if we've. So what is the status on? So maybe you could talk about the contract. Okay, so we pay for service. Do we pay based on household units in the contract that Metro or any contractor that we work with that they service? So we pay $13 per month to Metro to service a household unit to pick up household waste 8 times a month and recycling items. I think household waste is like $11.90 and recycling is like a dollar something per month. So that equals about $13 per household. How many households are in the contract that we're paying Metro to service versus what the actual number of household services that they're providing?
There's two different numbers to that, council member.
Correct.
I think there's two different numbers. There's the number that we have and the number that Metro has provided, and there's a distinction between the two.
So we should have the same, because sewage and water board bills, let's just say there's 80,000 households in Region 2. Sewage and water board bills that to 80,000 households, $24 a month. They collect the money, transfer that money over to the city, to the general funds, to pay the contractor. So if we receive $24 from 80,000 residents, then I have to assume that if it's in Region 2, Metro is supposed to service the 80,000 household. And they should be reimbursed their share of the $24 to service our citizen.
Mr. Chair, are you suggesting we pay Metro more money?
No, I'm not suggesting that. I'm suggesting that we should pay them for the services that they're providing. Any contractor that is providing service to the city, they should be paid for what they're servicing out. Because a citizen is paying for this.
I guess the contention is they're not providing that service that you're saying that we should be paying them for. And I think that is the crux of what we're trying to address. And I appreciate the discussion of the long-term contractual obligations and the dynamics related to the technical pieces of it. But once again, I think the administration completely acknowledges that this contract has to be rebid. This contract has to have structural changes. Whether or not that point that you're articulating is true, I won't even say yes or no, but it perhaps is. But the current need and the current vitality for us to go to the next level is to make sure trash is picked up at the current moment, but then in parallel, make sure that the contract is adequate for whomever bids on it. I mean, everyone will still have the same opportunity to bid on this contract, but it does need structural changes, as we discussed prior to this interaction you and I are having. So I just
I agree with you that trash needs to get off of the street. I think when you look at the process, if the company that we're working with, if we pay them correctly, we pay them what people are paying to service them, then they could pay their people, right? So in that way, they could be on the job to clear up the trash. So I think there's a lot of disconnect here, and I know there's a contract. This contract was in place prior to us being here. But I think it's still our responsibility to make sure that we fix the wrong. So in that way, people do not have to deal with this, because this existed during COVID-19, way before Ida. And I know that we have brought this up repeatedly. I know there's been discussion about transfer station as well. You know, we should have put that in place to make sure that we're cutting down the process of getting trash out of our community. Because in the East and the Lower Nine, and Venetia now, because geographically, we're like further in the east. So it takes almost 2.5 hours for a garbage truck to go back and forth to River Birch and then come back. That's wasted time. And so I really appreciate that the administration is looking to a transfer station. I think it's gonna be a long-term fix because as we move forward, we could have a COVID-20, a COVID-21. We don't want to waste resources in our community. We need to work smart and be more efficient with our step. One thing I wanted to add on, because I know that Ramsey mentioned that we only got one bid for Region 2, but I received emails from two companies, Waste 360 and L&L LLC submitted a bid for the emergency trash contract, so I didn't know why their name was not listed.
So the procurement process is a sealed process. I don't have visibility toward who submitted. I only have visibility to what respondents met the criteria for being looked at and evaluated and accepted. So I don't know specifically of either of those particular companies you're highlighting.
So we may have 10 companies that may submitted a proposal, but they may not meet the criteria.
Like I could have an LLC and I submitted it and I wouldn't be qualified to operate in that same kind of dynamic.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Banks, I know you want to speak. This is kind of what I'm thinking is that we have about 6 comment cards. So I'd like to go to Councilmember Banks, then the comment cards. Then I know you all have comments that you all want to raise too. So we want to make sure that the providers are given time as well. So Councilmember Banks.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And if you all have talked about this, I apologize for being late. The storm knocked out trees and created all kinds of debris throughout the city that FEMA is picking up, correct?
Our contractors are picking it up, but yes.
Right. But the storm also knocked out the power that caused the refrigerators and the freezers to go dark. Why isn't the garbage a part of the debris, considered a part of the debris resulting from the storm?
Chairman's, did you want to answer that? Or I mean, I see you waving your hand. I mean, I can take a shot at it, but I mean, if you have a more clear answer, go ahead.
Thank you very much, Councilman. I think historically, even Katrina, I think one of the council members mentioned the Katrina situation. The Army Corps actually did provide household garbage collection. Metro, as well as Richards, and I've heard some discussion this morning about national companies. If you recall, during Katrina, Waste Management was the national firm here in the city, and both Metro and Richards were subcontractors to them. Waste Management pulled out of this city after Katrina, and the two local companies stepped up. Post-Katrina, the city put out a competitive bid for waste collection after Katrina. Both Metro and Richards invested millions of dollars into responding to those contracts, and that's how we got here today. Household garbage collection was a part of the Katrina recovery for obvious reasons, and I think if FEMA is not addressing that on its first pass, it's clearly something that could be achieved by the city to have FEMA reimbursed or have their emergency contractors pick up household garbage. It's done all the time. Obviously, if you live in an affected area, it's difficult to get the garbage off the street. But companies in this region go to other disaster areas to collect on behalf of other waste operations in other cities. We do it all the time. It's not abnormal. A perfect storm has lined up with Hurricane Ida as well as the COVID situation. So we're working through that. So just to, and I want to make some more comments, but just to answer your question, it can be collected by your debris contractor as well. We did it for the Corps of Engineers post Katrina.
I don't want to interrupt, but I just asked our federal folks. That's why I stepped out. It is my understanding and articulation from the experts that it violates the Stafford Act, and that is the reason household trash and garbage cannot be picked up. The timeliness between Hurricane Katrina or Ida, I don't know, but for the legal answer, it violates the Stafford Act.
And Gilbert, I'm not a lawyer. And
it requires a waiver, Councilman, and it happens all the time.
Well, the reason I asked the question is because the debris is the debris. It was all caused by the storm. Now, whether you call it a tree branch or a piece of wood or a rotted ham, debris, I mean, that's up to you to call it what you want. But I think that there has to be some sensibility in this, and I think that no one can rationally say that garbage was just created because our citizens were negligent. The garbage was created because the power got knocked because we got hit by a Category 4 hurricane. So if FEMA's point in being here is to help us recover from a natural disaster, that is a direct result of the natural disaster. So it doesn't seem to be brain surgery to me to get from 1 to 2 with that. Now, I don't know what the waiver entails, but I would hope that somebody on the administration side is bamming on somebody's door asking for such a waiver or asking for some consideration, because again, if the trash is out there, whether it's tree branches or rotting meat, it is still out there as a result of the storm.
And Chairman's, one of the things I will highlight is that FEMA has been an incredible partner with us since day one at IDA. They've been at our EOC since and whatnot. So the short answer is yes, we're absolutely asking for the waiver, the eligibility to recover everything we possibly can through this storm. It's just not guaranteed. So yes, unequivocally since day one, we're trying to get FEMA to support the city in every single aspect. And they have really shown up and provided a lot of resources for both the city and the residents. So I do want to highlight, and their presence has been dynamic from day one, and the ask has been established, the eligibility and the decision based on FEMA is not known as of now, according to our federal folks.
And I don't want to go deep into the weeds because I clearly know this is way above my pay grade, but how long does that review process take? I mean, when are we going to know if they're going to say yay or nay?
I'm being waived 3 months approximately.
Well, that's a long time to have a rotting ham
But I think you bring an important point. Both the city and the administration, to solve this problem, does not care if we get reimbursed because it's such a vital necessity, right? So if it is $7 million to do all of this, as a city, we have to be prepared to put that money up front as we would with anything. We can't wait for FEMA. So in no way does what you're suggesting halt what we're trying to move forward on. If we get reimbursed from a financial standpoint, wonderful. It's vital. It's needed as a cash-strapped city, but that would not delay our progress moving forward or what we could be paying right now. So in no way are we waiting for FEMA to say yes or no. We're spending whatever money necessary to solve the problem right now.
No, I'm not insinuating that. Where I'm going is that if you got a contractor out there picking up trash and he's got two garbage cans and a pile of branches, he's just going to pick up the pile of branches. He's going to leave the two cans. That, to me, is not the smartest way to do this. Have them pick it all up, and then we'll figure out the nuances after. Now, I get it that contractually with FEMA, they are only contracted to pick up the branches. But if you're out there with labor, with a truck that's got space in it, it makes sense to me to get the rotten hams out the garbage can. So,
and part of it is a machinery issue. The 96-gallon barrel is not the same equipment that's being used to pick up the debris. So although it's a truck and labor, it's not the same resource that would be able to address the need for household waste through that 96-gallon barrel. So that is also part of the issue. If we could just have one, even if our crews out there in Operation Mardi Gras, they aren't doing the 96-gallon barrels either because of the equipment issue. Those 96-gallon barrels are, you know, in some cases 100-plus pounds, and they can't just be dumped. So that is a mechanical truck issue, which goes into the labor equipment operator. And I don't want to speak for the business necessarily, but I'm not sure it's so much the labor as much as the operator, the driver of it. I understand the Louisiana rules require both the CDL and 3 years of experience driving a sanitation truck, and that has been a significant impediment. One of the early discussions, why don't we have bus drivers? They have CDLs, start driving the extra trucks they have. I understand and appreciate that is not an option simply because of the requirements based, I believe, either on their insurance or the state laws related to their operations, that you have to have 3 years of sanitation driving experience, and that truly has been an impediment and created such a significant shortage. But I don't want to speak for the company or the business. That's just what I've been edified to.
Well, I'm going to tell you that the more we get into this, the sillier this sounds. So how do you get 3 years of experience if you can't drive until you got experience?
I don't disagree with the head banging against the wall situations we're running to at all. I'm not even going to question.
No, that was more rhetorical than facetious, but let me do a couple of others that are real. What is the facility on Elysian Fields called?
Transfer station.
Are you talking about the
transfer station?
Yes. Yeah, the Florida and Avenue transfer station.
And it is okay now to have garbage because the citizens have been asked or given the option to bring their garbage to that transfer station, correct?
Correct.
Okay.
And can I just make one small thing, and I know the mayor said it last night. In no way was the opening of that a shirking of responsibility for the city to pick up people's trash. And I don't want that portrayed. That was a direct request people had of the city to drop off a place, but in no way is the city asking people to go dump your own trash. This is a service that this is a basic service that the city requires our folks to ensure is done. So I just wanted to highlight that because I know that had been having some discussion. I wanted to clarify that in no way is a shirking or a substitute for what service the city is required to provide.
How many other facilities in Orleans Parish exist like that?
That's the only one.
Okay.
Without that is, yeah, correct. I mean, they're part of the discussion is potential temporaries that we're looking at in different, to, I think, Councilmember Moreno's question. But as far as the structure, yes. But I believe has been closed since 2007 until there.
All right. So that's where I'm going with the potential temporaries. What's the holdup on getting the temporaries opened?
I think what Ramsey articulated, that's what we're trying to figure out right now. I mean, I can tell you, macro perspective, you need the operators, you need the tipping scales and all the folks that can go in and operate this similar to that you have at Riverburgh. So you actually need a company or someone that is able to operate a landfill station, very different than just household drive-up, drop-off. To actually have a transfer station, and coupled with that, you need the DEQ clearance to allow for that to occur.
All right, the people who run the one at Elysian Fields, those are city employees or private contractors?
City employees, as I understand.
Okay. What's the problem with having trucks discard their full loads there? Why can't that happen?
So I think that's what, and I'm getting a little bit out of my lane, but I'll try my best. That is where the whole tipping fee. It's a different operation when you have it commercially set for sanitation trucks. There is a whole different process that has to instill, and maybe I'll look to my right to see if they can better articulate the distinction between household drop-off as opposed to actual commercial use and the requirements to designate that as an actual transfer station.
Well, and see, that's all that lawyerese, and again, I give all you guys credit for being so smart and educated. But at the end of the day, the public just wants the trash out. So what do we need to do to make it possible for a truck to dump on Elysian Fields so that they can cut down that three-hour, two-and-a-half-hour ride between New Orleans and River Birch?
If I was to establish, and we're tackling this issue from multiple tiers, if I was to establish where we have been looking to your direct question, I'd put that on tier one. That has been what we've been looking at and evaluating for the last several days. I hope within the next 4 or 5 days, we will have a positive opportunity in that regard. But there does have to be a lot of things coupled with zone change. It has to deal with a specific operator that can manage the commercial use of it and everything of the sort highlighted with that, and of course the DEQ clearance. But once again, this is something that we have been dealing with and addressing since we realized that emergency contract was coming as it was, and we hope in the very near future that is a solution, a viable solution, both for the temporary and the long term.
But Gilbert, see, that's where I'm getting twisted at, because the commercial dumping, he dumping the same rotten ham that you ask Ms. Smith to put in the back of her car to go dump. So at this point, I get all the legalese, but we're right now in a situation where we can figure all that out on the backside, but the immediacy of this problem says, why can't we do that now and figure out how to fix it later? If you've got the ability to be able to dump garbage there today, which is established by the fact that we have permitted citizens to dump, that same rotten meat that's in the back of a car is the same rotten meat that's in the back of the garbage truck. Now, how are we going to fix the pricing issue? However we need to do that, I'm not saying ignore that. Let's figure that out. But right now, waiting for an analysis or a five-day window to figure out how much we should charge, to me, just doesn't make sense. If we've got that asset there.
Capacity. We don't have capacity there. So let me just, maybe that's where we do not have the capacity there. It's less about the analysis. There is absolutely the legalese pieces of it, but we do not currently have the capacity right now.
Okay, so that's a different issue than going through the legalities of it. Now, the capacity of it, and walk slow with me with this. Once the trash is dumped out of the truck, out of Jimmy's truck, then it's transferred to a bigger truck and then brought to River Birch, correct?
Well, currently we're running
down. Well, not you, but whoever, if Ms. Jones brings her rotten meat there and dumps it, it's taken from that Elysian Field site, put on the back of a big truck, and then shipped to River Birch, correct?
Correct. Mm-hmm.
Okay. How often do those trucks leave?
Well, it depends on volume, Councilman, and I just get
thank you right there. It depends on volume.
Right.
So if we know we got more volume than we typically had, instead of having one truck, why don't we have two stage there? Because clearly the drivers that are driving the street trucks are different than the drivers that are driving the transfer trucks. So if we've got to stage transfer trucks, if a River Birch bound truck only holds three trucks, then we need to have three garbage trucks dump, fill that one up, let him pull out, and then dump three more. That to me does not seem like rocket science. If we could logistically stage this and those trucks could run as many hours as possible, and if it requires us paying a little bit more to River Birch to ask them to stay open 24 hours to let them dump 24 hours, there has to be a simpler way to do this. And I think we're complicating it, and I get it. I know the legal stuff is all of that, but I don't have a legal mind. I have a very, very logistical, analytical, simple solution mind. Get the garbage out of here and get it to where we're going to bring it. So if you got a stage four trucks to do that, okay, stage four trucks. And the cut down on that time will take some of the pressure off of these neighborhoods. Because, again, 3 hours there, I mean, a three-hour trip, you ain't picking up garbage in 3 hours. Right. So, again, help me again. I know y'all are very legal. But
sure. I'm not saying anything legal. This is actually simple and the practical pieces of it. The trucks that you were talking about that would take all of this, we don't have those. We don't have those. So that whole kind of process that, you know.
So who takes it now, Gilbert?
Well, that's they don't. They go to River Birch, right? I mean, that's why River Birch exists.
No, stop right there. The stuff that's dumped today, Ms. Smith loads up the back of her station wagon and brings that to Elysian Fields. It does not sit there in perpetuity.
Right, but
it gets out of there at some point. How is it moved from Elysian Fields to River Birch? How does it get there?
Much smaller capacity trucks.
Okay. And who drives those trucks?
I believe I don't know the.
City staff actually operate the facility, Councilman. I think the problem is the transfer station is outdated. It had been there for many, many years. Theoretically, it makes sense, but logistically, it'll be very difficult to take the kind of volume that both Metro and Richards and others would bring to that facility and get it in and out in a very efficient way.
Jimmy, if one neighborhood got relief, it would be worth it.
I agree.
If we could dump one truck faster than what we're doing, I think the public would be satisfied to at least that neighborhood, at least that street, at least them three houses, depending on how much stuff they got,
right,
would be happy that there's progress. Right now, we look like we're just stuck with nothing happening. So if it can't get all of it, if the elephant is too big to eat at once, then let's eat him at a bite at a time.
Right. What I can say, and I'll let you answer, Jimmy, what I can say is this is a solution the city will be doing. I mean, this is part of our plan. I'm just saying it will take to operationalize it a few days to ensure that we are there. I mean, it's going. I mean, that's what I'm telling you. This is not something that has been scrapped. This is something that we're working to address. But the difference between a good plan and a bad plan is often 30 minutes to make sure that we're doing it right, so that it is not creating more of a problem than a solution. And that's what we're trying to say. I wish it was simple as just moving trucks, but as I'm learning through each one of these sanitation complications, it's not that.
And Gilbert, are you going to need legislative authorization or something from this council to make this happen?
I believe that we would at some point need a zoning change to allow for that to happen. But I need to once again go back to what the emergency declaration does or doesn't allow. But I mean, at the minimum, I believe there has to be a zoning change. I have to have a sewer hookup to that and another piece of it. There's a lot of things that have to go into that, things that can be solved in days, not weeks or months, so that we can get this done in the next, you know, like Ramsey said, we're hoping Operation Mardi Gras is, you know, a 7-day operation. And then we hope with the advent of, you know, we did get a bidder for District 2 or Zone 2, and they have 20 trucks. I mean, with the money that they would potentially be receiving, they're moving everything in the world they can to try to get an operator to bring the trucks from Florida here. So this is not, this is something that we have to address in days, not weeks or months, as we're trying to solve both the bag debris issue, the debris issue, and then the household waste issue.
Right. Councilman, we had discussions with Sanitation Department, Mr. Torrey, as well as others in the city. I think the city have other assets that we asked them to consider. The old incinerator, I think, on Old Gentilly Road or Amonaster. We could have potentially brought our individual trucks to that facility, pushed the stuff on the ground for a minute, had another truck pick it up, put it in a bigger truck and run it straight to the landfill, as you stated, with the big trailers, as Councilmember Wynn has mentioned on several occasions as well. That's very doable. I think the city has property that we could temporarily do that, would save us a tremendous amount of time. It'll keep the trucks on the street, as you said, 2.5 hours each load longer, which will make a significant difference in how much ground we could cover on a daily basis. We've asked the city to look at it. I think the city is in the process, through property management, of looking at some of those other facilities as a possible alternative to Elysian Fields, because Elysian Fields is very difficult. But I think the old incinerator, even the Algiers incinerator, right at the foot of the bridge, and not trying to pick on any neighborhood, but I think there's an old auto pound that the city owns out on Old Gentilly or Elminster as well. So in my opinion, all of those sites are potential sites to at least be considered.
Mm-hmm. And Gilbert, if you could follow up to see if what, to confirm or verify what Jimmy is saying and find out where that process is, because that sounds faster than having to go through a whole legislative process of zoning changes and all of that. And again, we're in a crisis. So if we've got to call audibles, then we need to do that. So if you could verify that with your folks to see if that's a quicker fix to get it, and this will not be a permanent facility. This will be just enough to get us through this crisis, and then we can still be running on a parallel track to get more modernized transfer stations done with whatever zoning is required, but we got to get out of this hole right now. So Gilbert, if you could follow up and let me know that, I'd appreciate it.
I just want to, it is our people doing that right now. I mean, that is our people on the ground trying to figure out exactly what Mr. Woods just articulated. And so every opportunity we are exploring on the transfer station issue, that's one of those structural issues that has to be addressed to solve this problem short and long term, that we completely acknowledge. And in a couple of days, we should have a finalized answer to address every single one of these specific questions related to this transfer station ability. We won't be able to get the trash out nearly as fast as we need to unless this solution is had in at least the next couple of days.
Okay.
Gilbert,
hold on. Councilmember Banks had the floor for a long time. And so I know I'm not fussing at you, but I'm just saying, so there's a lot of people who have questions. I really want to get to public comment, though. And
mine's really...
If it's directed to his, go ahead. But
thank
I want
you.
To make sure these people aren't here.
All right, I will. I'm sorry. And the reason is, too, is I think there's another issue being met. There's, when you talk about the trash collection with debris versus garbage, right, there is a green letdown station, right? They actually have to bring it to certain areas for debris as opposed to household garbage. So that's another issue. So they can't necessarily, the same truck cannot necessarily pick up debris and household garbage at the same time. DEQ is not going to necessarily allow that. And also, you know, I have sent emails about additional transfer stations in other parts of the city. I think we need one. We need one in Algiers. We need one in New Orleans East. Mr. Woods is correct. Elysian Fields is not only not accessible for large scale, it's also not fair because we have regions of the city that are left out. And so I've consistently said that we need a recycling station, both in Algiers and New Orleans East. I have the emails, and I've asked for that. And in fact, even after Ida, I have requested that because you're dealing with LDEQ, now is the time to get LDEQ to certify other parts where this can be utilized. And we need, so what I'm hoping happens from this is that if you have LDEQ at the table, we also know how to do some of these emergency contracts for sanitation prior to hurricane season, which we have not done in the past, then we have to look at having these transfer stations, because there are differences between green waste and household waste and how it's treated. That's why it's not so simplistic just because you have one truck going down the street.
And,
right.
And you, thank you. And we don't disagree. And we heard you and believe it. And
I know y'all have heard me, but I have been asking for 3 years to have these types of situations in areas of the city that have been neglected.
Right.
For 3 years.
Right. Let me try to back up a little bit specifically. In the mid-year budget ordinance that is being heard, the money for this is in there. So it's a resource issue as well. But through the mid-year, we have money for this transfer station specifically tied to our sanitation cleanup NOLA. So we have money associated with this request. And look, remember all the cuts that we had to make, some of the new...
No, I know that, so, but we...
But for complete clarity, this is built into the mid-year to address, and it's vital for the future of the business model plan for success for whatever vendor is going to be responding to, or internal.
Right, and not just that, we have Algiers in New Orleans East are very blessed in that we have large amounts of land that are areas that are not, do not necessarily have neighbors surrounding them. So the impact can be very, very minimal, if any impact on any neighborhood, if it's done thoughtfully. Mm-hmm. And then also during the year, it can be utilized as a recycling area where people can, instead of having to go all the way to Elysian Fields, you can go to to get rid of tires or household waste or what have you. Again, making this whole concept of sustainability and trash and how we're going to deal with this as a city moving forward much better. And it's just something that I hope we take from this. And if we have LDEQ at the table right now, which I know we have them, because we're still in recovery, we should identify those sites now and get them at the table to approve them. Because I'm thrilled to hear that y'all have the money, but we also know what it's like to deal with LDEQ. I mean, they're not easy to deal with at all. And so if we can get them at the table with FEMA, I think we can make a better long-term solution. And that's why I'm here. I'm trying to find long-term solutions.
Yes, ma'am.
One quick thing. Just on the LDEQ piece. So, Dr. Brown last night was pretty clear that already the city is allowed to do these temporary transfer stations. I mean, there are requirements that LDEQ has about these, but... there's like a 30-day notice and things like that, but those things can be waived when it's an emergency. And really all that's necessary is for whoever will be operating this temporary transfer station to have a permit with LDEQ, and also that the administrative authority, being, you know, the city administration, allow for this temporary transfer station to occur. And so, you know, all of the issues of zoning and things like that, those requirements, because it's an emergency, can be waived if the city administration says it's okay.
And I'll repunctuate that. We have no disagreement, and they have worked with us, and they will work with us, and we're moving forward on that. On the zoning issue, I was just trying to answer a direct question that may not even be relevant based on the emergency powers. I think the mayor can make that change. So in no way do we feel as LDEQ, we're not seeing impediments right
now.
Yeah,
I think since there's no impediments, I think we need to pick the sites now. And get them figured out by this weekend. And then should there need to be any type of potential changes, you have a council meeting coming up on Thursday, or the mayor can do something beginning, you know, Monday or through the weekend.
And although I'm here addressing the council right now, I'm getting text messages literally that are saying these discussions that we're highlighting right now are being had right as we speak. So they are.
I just don't want to wait another 3 days just to go through and talk to LDEQ and whatnot. And when we already know that we can move forward with something like this. And so let's just go and try to figure out what sites are workable. What are the best sites for Jimmy and for others to be able to use? There are many industrial sites that are potential options, city sites that are potential options. So what does that look like? From what I understand, that these temporary transfer stations have to be cleared every night anyway. There has to be like a 200-foot buffer, no runoff or anything like that. So let's start just picking the sites and start putting the pieces together as to how we're going to operate them. If we've got, you know, all of these hundreds of employees out there collecting trash, that's a super tough job. I would think it's probably easier for them to be, you know, standing at a transfer station and seeing trucks come in and out all day than to be out there actually picking up trash. And that may actually lead to a faster solution to getting everyone's trash finally up.
Thank you. And
if I could just jump into, I think, Councilmember Palmer, in reference to sustainable solution, and I know that we've been in a pandemic for over a year, and so trash issue has been a concern, a delay in everything. And I'm glad that the administration is talking about transfer station. I know Jimmy has brought up transfer station in the past, and so I think moving forward, we know what happens in New Orleans at a certain time of the season. We know what we face every day in New Orleans. I think we need to make sure that we're proactive of being making sure that all of those are in place so that way we don't find ourselves in a disaster. On another note, Gilbert, on the FEMA situation.
Can I just highlight the transfer? We just got approved the third city storm debris site approved at the Gentilly area. So even as we're having these conversations, sites are being approved. So I just... Before you go to your next issue, and Councilmember Moreno, we just got a third storm debris site approved right now, and now we're trying to figure out solid waste. So the transfer station is a thing, and literally as I'm having these conversations, they're being approved.
Okay, thank you. So going back to the FEMA situation, Gilbert, and I know that we're pooling city employees, and I'm glad to hear that the city's putting up resources to take care of the trash issue pending FEMA's decision. But I definitely want to make sure that we aggressively pursue FEMA to make sure that this price tag is not put on the burden of taxpayer, because we're going to have other issues in our city that we need to use our revenue for as we continue to move forward. Remember when the incident with in the French Quarter with the rat in the French Quarter, FEMA immediately responded and helped the city to address that issue. And so for me, it's, and I guess I know we're working closely with FEMA, and we know that this was a Cat 4 that the city faced, and I'm a little bit shocked to hear that FEMA hasn't really approved of the household waste, because these household waste was caused by a hurricane. And so it should be classified as a disaster recovery, and that they should make the commitment in assuring that the city will get reimbursement for this resources.
Sure, and I want to say FEMA has been exceptional right now, and then the process of approval, the fact that it hasn't been approved right now is not uncommon. The city always, it's a reimbursement agency, so we would always put up the money first, and then in the next 3 to 4 months, we get through the project worksheet submittal, get decision on what's approved and not approved. So the fact that we don't know a yes or a no now should not be implicit in some way that FEMA is overlooking us in some form or fashion. This is normal part of their process.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Very quickly. Thank you, Gilbert. I think, you know, we've been here for an hour, and we need to get to hour and a half, and we need to get the public comment. You know, people's patience is wearing thin. What I would like to see is the administration articulate the solutions, concrete solutions, of how we are going to solve this problem. You just mentioned about the discussions behind the scenes. I believe that needs to be shared with the council as we represent the citizens that the administrations represent as well on the ground, so we could communicate what the plan is going forward. So what I'd like to see is the administration bring forth the council a plan in writing as to how we move forward.
Let me get clarity. Counselor, and let me try to rearticulate behind the scenes conversation. I'm not sure what the implication was, but that's
trying to
figure out how to have a concrete solution. So in no way is the behind the scenes conversation trying to overt the council's kind of role and importance in this. It's just making sure that we have concrete solutions before we go to the public so that we can ensure that there's probability in the long term of that specific solution. So we're not trying to solve this behind the scenes. When we have a solution, we absolutely will bring it. But I do want clarity on what you mean with a plan to address the the short term, the long term, the contractual issue? Because what I can tell you, at least on the long term side, there that is a legal document, that is a legal bid process. We have to evaluate the scope, what does and doesn't work, and that would be significantly more time-consuming than, say, what we are dealing with on the Operation Mardi Gras. We want to make sure, look, these contracts are for years, and choosing the right bidder moving forward is going to be vital. Not to mention, we're in the middle of a contract right now.
Right.
Their contract doesn't expire, I think, to 2024. Right. So this is a whole...
I'm talking about collaborating with the council on the plan going forward. What is the plan? And, for example... my 12 years, 13 years being former chairman of the Hurricane Recovery Committee that oversaw the dollars for Hurricanes Katrina, Rita, Ike, Gustav, my contacts with FEMA on the phone this week to see if the city makes its best case for solid waste removal. People have been having weeks of their fridges loaded up into the trash can, that this could possibly be FEMA reimbursable. And so that's the kind of communication and collaboration I'm talking about. So it wouldn't be an impact to the general fund of the citizens of New Orleans and our fund balance.
So, and no one cares more about the general fund than me, I assure you. One of the things that I'm happy to share, let me just level set where we are, and I think we're shifting to FEMA. When we submit that project worksheet for reimbursement, remember, we had the 100% reimbursable period, I think, from August 26th to 30 days thereafter, September 26th. We have to compile all the FALs, all the FAEs. It's very fastidious, and I'm happy to share any and all of those project worksheet deliverables that we do submit to FEMA and FEMA and the cases to any council member that would like. That is dozens and dozens of reams of paper, but it's important. I mean, FEMA tracks their information, and as an administration, we are as equally fastidious to ensure that we have that proper documentation as well. Now, that is something I'm happy to provide in any form or fashion, but it is a lot of information that you can use however you'd like, but it is what we plan to supply, that project worksheet and all the FAEs, all the FALs, so that shows every generator we used, the amount of time we used it, every truck, every vehicle, every person, when they worked, how they worked, what they did. This is all the information that we do provide FEMA that I'm happy to share with you if you would so like, if that is the request.
So the request is very short-term, long-term, a written plan to the council. How will the administration solve the sanitation issue? I think that is the theme of this meeting today.
Okay.
That's it. I yield my time. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Gilbert, before I get to public comment, who is the disaster recovery project manager for the city right now as a contractor?
I have it in my notes, unless...
All right.
Let me have it in my notes. For debris removal?
I mean, for disaster recovery. And I assume that would be debris removal. Who PMs that?
Oh, internal. Joe Threat is our...
But there's not a contractor. It's all done by Joe. Wasn't there SIDAC before?
Yeah, let me look. I have it. I believe it.
Lenitra, do you want to come up here?
Yeah.
So
sorry, you can go to the
microphone.
No,
that's okay. As she may have it off the top. Lenitra, she's our federal grants administrator, Hassan.
So we've had several contractors over the years. However, the city manages the process in-house now through the project delivery unit.
And so that's Joe Threat.
Yes.
Thank you. All right. So, Morgan, it looks like you have a card, too. I see that. I just want to get through the comments because people have been here for so long. I have one, two.
The debris contractors, Ceres, C-E-R-E-S, Ceres.
Yeah, I guess, Gilbert, my question is more about who's project managing, because I think that's really what all of our questions are about, right? I mean, in terms of Ceres is doing the debris pickup, which is great. That needs to be done. But in terms of site management, in terms of the transfer stations, in terms of...
you're talking the operational?
I mean, who's PMing it all? In the past...
This is being ran through the EOC,
right?
Is the short answer.
Okay.
It's being ran through the EOC. We have it activated as of 7 a.m. Within the EOC, we have logistics.
we have operations, and then we have emergency management relative to that. So each one of those core components within our EOC manages this as a whole. Obviously, we're treating the sanitation issue as a public health issue, so it's being managed through the EOC.
Okay.
Now, the PM, say, for sanitation would be Matt Torrey, the director. The PM for the grants issue is Joe Thread. I mean, so there's different levels of that, but centralized through our centralized command center of the EOC.
Okay. All right. I want to get to public comment. Everybody's going to get 2 minutes. That's the way we always do it. The first three people are Chris Lawrence, Captain Amaker, and Don Hebert. So, Mr. Lawrence, are you here? Good morning, sir.
Good morning, everybody in the City Council of New Orleans. My name is Chris Lawrence. I'm the president against the forces of all evil, a nonprofit.
Can you come over to the main podium right there, right next to you? It's just the mic's better, and make sure you lower the mic.
Can you hear me, Ms. Moreno?
Much better, much better.
I see you in 2025. You're going to be the next mayor of New Orleans. Anyway, to make a long story short, I used to be a garbage hopper for our Metro Disposal in 2017. This is my best solution. Sidney Torres and Mr. Ramsey Green. I spoke with Ramsey after he left the council chambers a half an hour ago. He wouldn't have a problem getting with Sidney Torres. Let Sidney Torres be the coordinator over all the sanitation in the city of New Orleans, starting with removal of Metro Disposal from the French Quarters. Give Ivy Sanitation the contract for the French Quarters. If they get the contract for the French Quarters, Bourbon Street, Royal Street, he's going to bring 3 times a week lemon bleach to the streets. That's going to solve the problem. The French Quarters, I already talked to the business people. This is what they want. Ivy will handle the French Quarters. Metro and Richard's going to handle the rest of the city. Ramsey's Green going to coordinate with Sidney Torres. They're going to be the two people, the brains of the future long-term plan for the city sanitation. We're not going to have no problems.
30 seconds.
I got 30 seconds?
Yes, sir.
Nobody will lose their jobs. They're going to have a salary. I was a hopper. I worked the trucks. I know how hard it is. Nobody going to be played when it's time to pay them. Pay these guys their money. They work hard. They sweat long hours, overtime. These guys work 75 hours a week, okay? Hey, you got to pay the hoppers. I'm a former hopper. I've been there, done that, and I know. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Captain Amaker?
Hi, my name is Keith Amaker. I'm a retired naval officer. I've lived all over the world, including Kabul, Afghanistan, where I've seen third world up front. Personally, sanitation, water, those sort of things, I've seen what it's like when you don't have it. The problem is Metro. Prior to the storm, 27th of August, an IV waste truck, Sidney Torrey's crowd, picked up my garbage in Lakeview, where I live, as a request to 311. The week before, my recycling was picked up by Metro on the Wednesday prior to the storm. That was done by a Metro truck. I have not seen a Metro truck except for that one recycling truck for the entire summer. Every time my garbage has been picked up, it's been an IV waste. I've learned from Metro and IV that there's an exchange of streets provided from Metro to IV. IV takes and executes that. There's a contractual relationship of some sort between IV waste and Metro. It took 10 days to figure out what we already knew before the storm, that the non-compliance of the contract by Metro is the problem. It's already been articulated. There's no need for me to say it again. Getting that contract amended, getting Metro to comply with the contract, will solve the problem. I admire the city's effort, their Tiger Team effort with Operation Mardi Gras to solve the immediate problem. I admire the city's response and the council's comments. They're all germane, they're all valid. But as a citizen out there packing and racking garbage, waiting for Metro to respond and begging and pleading, and last Wednesday, I got my garbage picked up by multiple 311 requests for every neighbor around me and calling and begging Metro on the phone and told, call after 3 and maybe we can tell you when you can pick up your garbage. That is like trying to get out of the Kabul airport, which costs 500 Afghanis to bribe your way out of the airport. That's the same kind of mentality of third world garbage, no pun intended, that I think the service should be provided as contracted. The $24 comes out of my sewage and water board bill every month. I've been paying it. Sewage and water board bill says, you got to talk to the council about that. You got to talk about sanitation. So I'm not getting any value for my money. I'm paying it. I'm not getting it. And the only way it gets correct, the only way my garbage can is empty right now is because I begged and pleaded in 311 my entire block to get Metro to hand me to IV waste. Something is going on with IV waste and Metro that has to be resolved. Sydney Torres may be the answer. I don't know. I know contractual compliance that was non-existent prior to this storm has created the situation that we have now that must be resolved.
Captain, please wrap up. Thank you.
Done. Thank you, sir.
Dawn Hebert, Arania Jesse, and Michelle Riley.
Hello, everyone. My name is Dawn Hebert, and I just want to say, as a New Orleans East resident, we were definitely concerned when we saw that a contractor was hired to deal with Richard's disposal. Yet, New Orleans East residents, many of them, have not had trash picked up in over 4 weeks. So we definitely have a hazardous, unsanitary condition in New Orleans East. Children are going back to school. They're either walking past this trash or they're standing near it to catch a school bus. We don't understand why we have not had the same service, and I'm listening to this guy about IV waste. Why have they not been sent to New Orleans East to help with the trash pickup? Why are we not being assisted with additional funding, probably? Is there not a debris management plan? I mean, we have hurricanes here every year, practically. So why is something or why is nothing in place to deal with this type of problem? And I enjoyed, listening to the comments today, and I think it should have happened before today. But in dealing with that, I was also here in July when we discussed this. Trash was not being picked up again. We discussed notification of residents as to when they would have a scheduled pickup. We have been tired of moving trash from the front to the back. When we hear the truck, you got to run to the front to bring the truck. I mean, the dumpster.
Also, 30 seconds.
Okay. So anyway, I would like some information. When can we expect regular trash pickup? Is there ever going to be a recycle pickup again? Are we going to be reimbursed for the services that we have not received? So these are all questions actually that we need, and we need everyone up on the podium. You're in charge. We need your help with getting this solved. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Arania Jesse, Michael Riley, and Susie Cobb. Good morning.
Good morning. I'm surprised you don't remember my name, Joe. This is Irena Jesse.
I'm sorry.
And we know each other. 1809 North Salcedo Street. I am a homeowner. I am a taxpayer, and I pay sewage and water board. I live on the cross streets of Derby Place and Trafalgar. They collected the garbage. In fact, they pretty much collect the garbage often, but they will not come down North Salcedo Street, which is the cross street. This has been going on before Ida. In fact, the week before Ida, they picked up the garbage. I see them, and they will not come to our block and pick up the garbage. There are only two residents, but there's five neighbors that put their garbage on North Salcedo Street. So we're dealing with five cans of garbage since before Katrina. I have put in complaints to Metro constantly. I have put in 311. Joe and Amanda both have sent emails to somebody asking them to address my concern of why they don't pick up on the cross streets. So this is my main complaint. And one more thing. My neighbor across the street, bless her heart, she couldn't take it no more. She paid somebody, some private garbage company, to come out and pick up her garbage. Our block smells horrible. So please consider 1809 or the 1800 block of North Salcedo Street, 70119. It's a place that needs to be picked up. I'm paying for it, but I'm not getting it. And I'm telling you, this has been happening since way before Ida, where I have to call up and tell them that they're not picking up my garbage. My can stays out 24/7. Thank you.
Thank you. And I was going to repeat your address if you didn't do it, so I appreciate saying it one more time. All right, we have Michael Riley, Susie Cobb, and then Pearl Cantrell.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I've had enough. I've just had enough. I am 67 years old. I started working in city government with the Moon Landrum administration. I have seen politicians come and go, but this is a travesty. I have at least 13 years experience in response and recovery with FEMA. I am a resident at 6044 Press Drive. I have not had my garbage removed for over 4 weeks. I live across the street from the golf course. Imagine the insult it is to see the golf course clean and stinking trash still up and down my block. You tell me City Park is open. How can you open City Park and I can't open my door? This doesn't make sense. FEMA is a reimbursement. This administration, every time they call FEMA's name, says they're working with them. Well, FEMA serves at the pleasure of the state. Is the city talking to the governor? The city can't control the Corps of Engineers. The city can't get people out here on these streets through FEMA and pay those bills unless the governor assents to it. I know how big everybody feels that we're New Orleans.
30 seconds.
But this is a team effort. Disaster recovery requires work from the state down to the local, the lowest local stakeholder. And we are at the bottom of that. We need to get this act together. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Susie Cobb, Pearl Cantrell, Morgan Clevenger.
Hi, I'm Susie Cobb. We know we've had a disaster. The people in the city are willing to be patient. We're willing to say we got to pull together. I have people who haven't gotten their garbage picked up since August 23rd. It was picked up 2 days ago. I will tell you that I was at the point of naming every maggot in my garbage, and I was going to put them on my income taxes dependent if we had to wait for FEMA for 3 months. This is a disaster. We need to think outside the box. What's wrong with getting big, big dumpsters? Put them up and down the large streets. I lie about how tall I am, and I tell everybody I'm 5 feet tall. So I can't pick up one of those big cans and put it in something. But those big dumpsters have a handle on them that you can open it up. I can walk my garbage can in and I can dump my garbage. People don't mind cooperating and helping out. But to be told that, oh, we're making a plan now, it's 17 days since the storm. That plan should have been made 2.5 years ago, at least. This is unacceptable. It is totally unacceptable. This is not good government. This is just incompetence. I'm sorry. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Cobb. Pearl Cantrell, Morgan Clevenger, and then the last card I have is Elaine Boutte. Good morning.
Hi, I'm Pearl Cantrell, 7620 Crestmont Road. I'm here representing myself as well as the Kenilworth Improvement District. I came before you in July when Mr. Woods came and said he was going to have everything done and be back to normal by the end of July. That date changed to August the 10th, and I don't know what the date is now, but every time I call his office, I get another date. Last Wednesday, I got a call, and it said, Ms. Cantrell, we're going to pick up your garbage between Thursday and Friday. I failed to ask them what Thursday and Friday, because it didn't happen that last week, and doesn't look like it's happening this week, because today is Friday and the garbage is still sitting out there 4 weeks. Like the lady said, I'm about to start naming my maggots, because we're about to do a second line down Crestmont. It's just no excuse for the lies that have been told over and over again by you, Mr. Woods, by your company, Mr. Woods, and by everybody who listens to him and repeat the lies that he tells them. I'm sick of it. Everybody's sick of it. We shouldn't have garbage sitting in front of our door for 4 weeks. And now the new plan that the mayor's come up with, we're going to pick up the bags, but we're going to leave the garbage. They got garbage sitting outside the cans in bags. So you're going to pick up some of the garbage, but you're not going to pick up the other garbage? What the world? What's going on? Is everybody going crazy? I'm not the only one that got sense? Because it seems like that.
30 seconds.
I've been retired from the city for 15 years. I put in my time under five different administrations. I'm almost 74 years old. Why do I have to carry my garbage to a dumpster on the corner? That's a stupid idea as far as I'm concerned. Why do I have to carry my garbage to the landfill or wherever the hell y'all designate as an area to put it? I shouldn't have to do that, nor should any citizen. But you continue to collect my $24 every month, and I continue to have garbage, trash, debris, whatever you want to call it, hanging in front of my door and up and down my block. They came to my block is from 7,400 to 7,600. They picked up 7,400 and left 75 and 76 sitting there and didn't come back. What the hell's going on? You don't have to be a rocket scientist to figure this out. Somebody needs to start doing their job, and it needs to start with this man sitting here since he's representing the city. He's sitting up there bubbling and babbling like, I don't know, he don't know what the hell's going on. I'm tired of it, and I'm sure every citizen in this city is tired of it.
Thank you, ma'am. Last two speakers, Ms. Clevenger and Butte.
Good afternoon. How you doing, Mr. Woods? I don't know you by the name of Jimmy. We know you by the Metro. And Metro has failed. Has failed over and over and over again. For those of us who stayed under the shelter-in-place idea, 9, 10, 11 days of no power. It was so hot in the houses. Everybody's out on their stoop. Everybody's out on their porch. But you're sitting amid garbage that hadn't been picked up in 4 weeks before the storm. That's not acceptable. It's a public health hazard. So you're sitting there at 3 a.m. on your porch and you see the rats coming at the garbage, tearing it up. You see the raccoons, opossums. I mean, how are we living? This is impossible. We cannot do this any longer. I hear the council people calling you Jimmy. I don't know you as Jimmy. I know you as Metro. Why do you still have this contract? I don't understand it. Next, why are we being asked to bring garbage in our own personal vehicles to a waste station? Garbage that's been sitting there for weeks. We have elders, we have seniors, we have handicapped people. They can't possibly do this. What we did in our neighborhood 2 days ago, we started with our neighbors who had pickup trucks, and we went down every block and we shoveled up that garbage and we put it in the pickup trucks. But now we have a cottage industry where people are wanting to charge $14 a bag to bring it to that transfer station. This is creating just more and more chaos. The inconsistency of what we're doing, not having a plan. I'm glad you're all here talking about it now, but as you've heard, everybody's at their wits' end. We can't live like this anymore. We thought of getting that dumpster. We called around yesterday trying to find dumpsters to put at the ends of the neighborhood. But then we come back to the problem of how do we get the trash into the dumpster? So just those logistical problems that we have been trying to determine on a neighborhood level to rid us of this obscene living situation, We're coming up with, you know, stopgap solutions, but we're looking for you guys to give us the plan. And we'll work with you.
Ms. Clevenger, thank you.
That's your okay. time.
Thank you for your comments.
All right. Thank you.
Next up, last in-person public comment card is Ms. Elaine Butte. That was Ms. Elaine.
My name is Elaine Butte. I live at 2907 O'Rodder Street. And New Orleans.
Come up a little bit closer to the mic, ma'am. There you go. I just want to be able to hear you. Thank you.
My name is Elaine Butte.
Good morning.
I live at 2907 O'Rodder Street. No one have never come pick up the garbage smell. We live like on the third. Well, them people live on the third world. And it's sad. And I think New Orleans should do better than that. Because y'all look like New Orleans look like a ghetto town. And it's sad. And I think y'all should put God first in y'all life and look at the poor people. I know some of y'all rich, but y'all should look at the poor people, how they living and all that garbage. Ain't moving. But y'all have money to pay other people come and pick up their garbage. And this is just a disgrace. And the mayor said yesterday all the garbage pick up. She lying, because she don't look around. I look around, and he said it's a disgrace to New Orleans. New Orleans was a pretty city, but it looked like a dump. Sad. Disgusting to live in. It looked like a ghetto town. And it used to not look like that. And y'all got to wake up. The people above and take over and walk out there and see what's going around in y'all city. But y'all city look bad.
30 seconds.
Y'all city look bad. You go to other town, it look good. Even City Hall look bad. It's pitiful. It's pitiful. Downtown look bad. Y'all just look like a ghetto city. And it's sad to say it. I live here, but the New Orleans went down. And all y'all is talking about money. Money, you get money, put it in your pocket. You ain't take it with you, you gonna leave it. That is for the poor people, to help the poor. Y'all don't help the poor. Y'all putting everything in y'all pocket, even the mayor. I don't know who got her to be a mayor. It put in a shame, because she bad. Here, ghetto woman. Bye-bye.
All right. That ends public comment. We also have 166 online comments. I'm going to limit that to some time period. I guess from my perspective, I still don't have some answers that I'm looking for, and I have a lot of questions, but primarily for the one where I don't know where Ms. Hebear went, but for neighborhoods that haven't been picked up, who just haven't been touched since the storm, is there a schedule where we're getting to them? What can I tell somebody who's emailed me for 5 consecutive days and said, I'm on day 21, I'm on day 22, I'm on day 23, I'm on day 24 of no pickup. What am I supposed to tell that person?
And I'll defer to the contractors. Let me just make sure, because I can think I can answer 2 of them. Are you talking, and I get this is part of that weird delineation, I don't mean to intend to, but it has a specific answer. Are you talking about debris removal or bags outside of the trash can, or are you talking about the trash can?
I'm talking first about waste. I will ask about debris eventually. I mean, I also think
trash Gilbert, can or no trash can?
Well, I mean, so trash can first, but you're also honing in on a question I have too, is are we going to start telling the public if your trash can's overfilled and you haven't been picked up, put it right next to it, because then maybe Operation Mardi Gras will get it too. I mean, I'm genuinely confused about what we're supposed to be telling the public about what they're supposed to do with their garbage, because they're supposed to be pick up in the can. Then we told people you're only going to pick up what's in the can. Now we're telling people we're going to pick up what's outside the can. So I want to make sure I understand what the messaging is. while we're all here.
I'll let them jump in on the schedule, but then I'll hopefully highlight the Operation Mardi Gras, which I can speak more directly to.
Okay.
Councilman, as of today, we have passed every neighborhood in our service area, Area 2, at least once. We'll continue to do that on a regular schedule.
Can I ask you this, Mr. Woods?
Yes, sir.
You may have passed in each neighborhood, but doesn't mean every street has been picked up in each neighborhood. And I guess the reason why I ask it is I've got to rely on my constituents who are telling me, I'm on South Sado, my trash hasn't been picked up. I realize these couple I'm going to name aren't you, but I've got 1100 block of Cherokee that hasn't been picked up. I've got Jennerette that hasn't been picked up. For me, Bayou, a large part of Faubourg St. John hasn't been picked up. Country Club Gardens hasn't been picked up. So I'm just telling you those
right. And I understand I get those same type comments from friends and associates in some of those neighborhoods. But I can assure you that we've passed down literally every street in our service area, Councilman. I think what happened initially, some of our first passes were before every resident made it back into their home. So initially, the passes we made, there wasn't a lot of garbage on the street, but we had already gone through those neighborhoods. As folks started to come back, the volume increased, of course. But it just takes a long time, just based on the manpower constraints that we had, to get back. But we have made it several passes to every street, particularly in your service area.
Well, what I mean, again, I'm trying to streamline this process because we're getting so many emails and phone calls and social media. What do I tell somebody who says to me, I'm on day 24, my trash hasn't been picked up?
I don't believe it's the case, Councilman. You know, obviously we were all evacuated for 8-9 days, and obviously those numbers are the 24 days
I'm
include.
I'm sorry, but he's lying. I mean, I've been back since the Monday after the storm.
Ma'am,
I saw them pick up in my neighborhood, and I saw them not pass in my block. So he can't say that they passing when they passing where they want to pass, and they missing where they want to miss. Don't make an incorrect statement, a blatant lie, and say that you've been picking up the garbage. Well, my garbage's been sitting on that curb forever. I mean, there's maggots, and like they said, there's rodents out there now. Mm-hmm. Right. People have their garbage out, and they're not picking it up. Thank you.
So I guess, Mr. Woods, look, I don't want to get into the back and forth, has or hasn't. My question is, having listened Ms. Jesse, listening to Ms. Hebert, listening, and again, just the emails that I'm getting. What do I do? Because I'm directing them right now to sanitation, and sometimes things are getting addressed, sometimes they're not. I'm trying to figure out for particularly the district council members and also for the administration and for the contractors, what do we do about people who've said, and look, I trust me, after being a district council member for 3.5 years, I know that not everything we get is exactly the way that it's, but I just have a woman here who's saying hers hasn't been touched. So how do we help her?
And Councilman, I respect the citizen's position in terms of not having service. Obviously, we haven't met the targets that we like as a company. We've served the city for decades, and obviously we've struggled through the last several months of COVID, and now Ida. We're addressing that. We're doing everything we can. We're not sparing any resources to get this thing back on track, and we'll continue to do that. Somebody mentioned that I lied about a date that I had set previously. What we did was gave our best guesstimates in terms of how long it would take us to recruit and train up drivers and get them back in here. We fell short of that, but there's no advantage to us to give you or the citizens a date and not try to meet it. I mean, we're doing everything we can to address the issue. We talked earlier about some of the other waste companies. We reached out to literally every waste company in this region, and we belong to an association. We put out a call across the country. Anybody have any additional resources, come on in. I don't care what the rate is, we'll pay it. We had zero takers on that national call. This is the environment we're living in. And we're doing everything we can to deal with it. And somebody mentioned, well, why is it just Metro and not the other contractors? Well, there's a story behind that as well. If you recall, in the beginning of the pandemic, and I'm not trying to disparage any other company, but in the very beginning of this pandemic, the problems were in Jefferson Parish. And a national company by the name of Waste Connections was being threatened by the council to run them out of town because of the inconsistency of service. Waste Connection, in turn, hired a local firm to come in and operate the West Bank of their operation. Because they were so stretched, they consolidated and brought in another operator. The same thing applied to my dear friend Alvin Richards when he had hit a bump early on in the pandemic. And Romelli happened to have some additional vehicles, so they combined. So Metro was the lone company standing on its own through this pandemic, and through the last 4 or 5 months, we hit a wall to where it was telling on us just like it did everyone else, and we're trying to work through it. My good friend Cindy Torres, who stepped in, and we appreciate his help, he has helped us to the extent that he can, and we welcome that, and we'll continue to do that. But we've reached out to Waste Pro, Waste Connections, River Birch, who has kept the landfills open longer when we asked them on Sunday, and we do work 7 days a week. And mind you, that my employees, and I want to tip my hat to them, because they work 7 days. Their homes are torn up. They haven't even had time to put on a blue tarp. But they're back every day, rain, sleet, or snow, trying to get the garbage off the street in this city. We're not shirking our responsibility, and I'm not making one excuse. We're doing everything humanly possible to get this thing back on track. And we're not sparing any resources to that, Councilman.
I understand, but I guess just my very simple question is, when we're getting the complaints, who do I direct them to?
I understand complaints, but I want the public to keep in mind, one, we're still in a COVID environment that's affecting every line of business in our country, whether it's manufacturing or service. And two, we're in the midst of a recovery from a Category 4 storm. So there will be complaints, Councilman, and we're going to address them as quickly as we possibly can. If they leave the cart on the curb, I promise you we'll collect it.
I get that, but I think what people are saying, and I think is right, is I'm looking for like a triage system, right?
Yeah.
Like this, let's just say the person who says their trash hasn't been picked up, or Miss Jessie who says my trash hasn't been picked up in 24 days is right. It would seem to me that they have a higher priority over somebody whose trash was picked up 3 days ago. So I'm trying to figure out, how do I tell somebody on North Salcedo whose trash hasn't been picked up, your trash is coming today or tomorrow, and somebody whose trash was picked up 2 days ago, it's going to be next Thursday before we get to you.
What we've attempted to do logistically is, one, run the regular garbage routes. In addition to that, we dedicate 2 trucks to what we call hot spots, and we move them outside of the regular collection schedule to try to take care of those matters that are of some type of emergency. And if we get those calls and get those identification, and I do get them from Councilmember Wynn all the time, we dispatch people to take care of them.
All right, and do I, again, who do I tell, who's the hot spot director?
Just tell them to leave it on the curb, Councilman. If it's identified, we'll take care of it.
Okay, do I email Mr. Brown? I'm just trying to figure out who to...
You can send it to Mr. Brown, or you could reach me directly.
Okay, all right, so go ahead.
Yeah.
Councilmember Wynn, then Councilmember Brissett.
Jimmy, where are you at today?
I'm sorry?
Are you still in the east in the lower nine?
No, we're in Gentilly.
Yeah. So, you know, I sent you a list last night.
I received it.
Yeah. I think Crestmont was one that Ms. Pintrell.
It's been addressed. Yeah.
We addressed it
this morning, yes.
Okay. But I just got a text. Northgate has been one on your list for several days now. Just got a text and a picture that their cans, I'm not talking about the trash bags, the can has not been serviced. So I mean, and again, I hear what you're saying. I've seen the guys out there, and kudos to the hoppers, you know, and I know that a lot of our neighborhoods have been really helping a lot of the hoppers and the men that are working with Metro to help them, because I've seen where neighbors are helping to throw the trash into the garbage can as well. So I know we're in a very unique time.
Councilmember, we've had drivers accosted by citizens.
Yep. No, you and I talked about that.
I had one had a gun pulled on him by a resident. Another one was hit with a baseball bat. That gentleman showed back up to work the next day and continued to come collect garbage. It's a tremendous amount of folks dedicated to try to clean up this city that are members of Metro's team, and we'll continue to do that. I just want the public to know that we understand the frustration. I'm frustrated as well. I don't like the stench. But again, consider the environment that we're in. We're not taking it for granted. It doesn't help us financially to not collect the garbage. We haven't shirked our responsibility. We're throwing more money at this thing than we're making to solve the problem. I'm importing folks from Mississippi and putting them up in hotels and giving them three meals and paying them a premium dollar to be here to collect. And we've been doing that for months. And we'll continue to do it until we get this solved. I will not shirk my responsibility, and I accept responsibility to the extent that we haven't met the goals that we've established over decades of serving the city. And I'll continue to do that.
And I know I appreciate you working with me even prior to the Ida. You know, we've been dealing with this trash issue. But I guess for me, going back to what Joe was saying, that there are streets that we're getting constituent telling us that they've been missed. And I text you the actual address,
right?
You know, because I can't make this up. I mean, I can't.
Right.
I'm getting it, and I copy and I send it to you. You know that every single day.
And we dispatch folks to look at it and address it when we can.
All right. So, thank you, Joe.
All right. Councilmember Palmer, do you want to weigh in? Sorry. Councilmember Brissett first.
Thank you. Thank you, Chairman. Gilbert, this is something I really would like you to think about as a quick and expedited solution. One, want to get your thoughts on what do you think the most immediate solution is, expedited, to get more of the trash picked up off the streets. And I'm going to give you my overview. I think that the FEMA waiver through Congress is a fair approach. CRES is the current contractor, correct, for storm debris? Storm debris is refrigerated debris. Refrigerated debris is being put into, storm debris is being put into our trash receptacles and cans. I believe that, and I think you should take back, calling on CRES to begin helping with the refrigerated debris. And the debris haulers have the emergency equipment to take and haul off this waste, the solid waste as well. They have the capability as part of their job. And I think, as you well know, and I know from background, that the Stafford Act has waivers for public health emergencies. And I think we call upon, of course, Congressman Carter and our former congressman in the White House, who is the point on recovery, to assist with those waivers. I think that's a fair approach to expedite getting this trash off the street. CRES is in the city right now, and I believe they could start assisting with that refrigerator debris.
We Chairman's, yes, we're actively and we appreciate and we'll entertain each one of those suggestions moving forward, many of which we are currently working on, specifically related to the FEMA issues. Did you want me to address your question right now as well?
Well, yeah, about calling on CRES to assist.
Yes, we will. We will absolutely explore that. I know that work has been done to explore that, and we'll have a more definitive response forthcoming for you as related to that question.
Councilmember Palmer.
Thank you. I'm going to break my question down to emergency contract versus existing contracts. So there's been a lot of talk about emergency contracts and whether or not they were done before the emergency, right? It's my understanding most emergency contracts are done prior to hurricane season and they're signed, correct? And so they come into action once we have an emergency. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, so that did not happen with sanitation, correct? It hasn't been treated as an emergency contract, or has it?
The debris piece
was, yes.
The
but not household sanitation.
No, that came post as an emergency.
Right. So I'm stating this because I want the public also to understand. So because we're just throwing out emergency contracts a lot, and people don't necessarily understand it. So for public, all of the debris contracts have already been effectuated prior to Katrina. I mean, see where I'm going with this? Prior to hurricane season, and then it's affected now, right? So let's talk about the emergency then contracts that y'all put out after Ida dealing with sanitation, right? Y'all did those.
Yes.
And then how many days after the storm did you do that? Do we remember?
I have it. September 8th, we issued the emergency procurement to provide additional solid waste.
Okay. So for household pickup for emergency contracts, that went out September 8th. And then how many bids in that did y'all receive?
And then we extended the response period by 3 days post the closeout of that. I want to highlight that because we had no bidders at our original closeout date. So then we extended it 3 calendar days, and we received received responses from 2 companies. Essentially, that is what I have
right.
as far as my information.
Okay, and then so those bids were divided into the current area, so it was just Area 1 and Area 2.
Yes.
Right? So Metro's Area 2.
Yes.
Right? And then Richards is Area 1.
Yes.
And then we also have the French Quarter DDD, but that's yes. a different one. And that's also just for the public's consumption. That's not Mr. Woods. That's not Metro. It's a different company altogether. That's Empire. Correct? So was there a differential in bid costs for Area 1 versus Area 2? From the respondents?
I'm going to look at my procurement, or at least to see. I don't know. Let me make sure I can get that information on the difference of cost.
Okay, because was Area 1 awarded the first emergency contract and not Area 2?
Correct.
So why didn't we put trucks into a more affected area, which was Area 2, first, as opposed to Area 1?
I think I understand your question. Are you saying why didn't we move resources that are currently in Area 1 to Area 2?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think Romelli, for example, that bid on Area 1, and Richards, I think that would be their prerogative to move that into Area 2 because they did not bid on that. They did not want to respond to that specific area in that area. So
I guess that's my question about these emergency contracts. We know that there were areas of the city that were suffering worse than other areas.
Right.
And so why did we not allow the city within the emergency bid to then give more resources to Area 2?
I think we opened up the checkbook for Area 2 and Area 1. I don't think there was any, had there been a company wanting to go to Area 2, they would have been in Area 2.
I guess what I'm saying is we should determine, or the city should be the determining factor on how bids are awarded. Right. Yep. And they're the ones that set the parameters of a bid. So I would hope that we set the parameters of the bid to help those areas of the city that were most affected. Like, obviously, New Orleans East was much more affected than Algiers. So I would have hoped that these emergency bids that came in were going to those areas that were more affected than other areas, because we had areas of the city that did not have trash pickup even prior to Ida.
Right. I get your line of questioning, and we just had no one that would respond. There would have been nothing the city could do, whether to delineate between Area 1 and Area 2, if no one is willing to bid on Area 2, with the exception of the one company, I think, from Minnesota that has trucks in Florida that we're trying to get drivers to back to New Orleans.
Right. But I guess so maybe a lesson learned is why separate an emergency bid by area. It should be based on need.
Yeah,
I hear what you're saying, and I think that is the target approach that we're dealing with on Operation Mardi Gras. We divided into 52 zones now from district or from Area 2 to be able to address that overlap of trash. So I think what you're asking, why didn't we make it that specific to the RFP?
Or that open, that the city has the ability to pivot to the areas of the city they're in most need.
Mm-hmm.
Because we have the data to back that up from 311 calls. I have here just within 3 weeks, over 9,000 311 requests, and I have them broken down into my district versus other districts. Mm-hmm. So I guess what I'm saying is I would have rather have seen a bid, an emergency bid, that was going to affect the areas in the most need. Does that make sense? Okay. Can we pivot then to the existing contracts? And it kind of goes along what Councilmember DeRusso was saying. Does the city have any independent way to verify who has received garbage service versus those who've not received contracted services? What is our independent way of verifying that garbage has been picked up or not picked up?
From the can?
Mm-hmm.
Just through reports. I mean,
so we have to rely on self-reporting from 311 to determine whether or not. You want to say?
Oh,
they sent a dashboard yesterday, right?
There's so many different pieces. So yes, there's the dashboard. I'm not sure that's what you were asking. Are you talking about?
I just want independent verification. I mean, you know, if we had a way that we're not relying on reporting, right? I know within the contract, I've read all of them. They're very interesting if anybody else wants to read them. You know, the trucks are required to have GPS, right? According to these contracts.
I know what you're talking about. Now, yeah, there is a dashboard requirement on the emergency contracts to answer.
Not emergency. I've gone back to our original contracts. Okay. I'm sorry. Now I want to talk about how we're holding the trash contracts accountable. So to me, a third party, I know we're talking about a dashboard, but we're also, through these contracts, are requiring them to have GPS. And we've had a lot of members of the public here today saying that they've never had their trash picked up ever since before Ida, so shouldn't there be a way that we can verify it? Because my questioning is now going to how within the contract there's also unsatisfactory performance damages that can be collected or taken away from what we're paying the contractor, right? So in order to do that, if there are service failures, how are we identifying what the service failures are? And are we holding the contractor accountable?
The short answer is yes, and that is part of that process that I said we currently and actively are engaged in, but primarily focused on ensuring that the trash is getting picked up for this urgent need. And in no way are we shirking that. And I think your question is, do we have a way to prove or not prove that they violated the contract? And from my team, the answer is yes. We do have a way to determine whether or not they fulfilled the contractual obligations as required that you're highlighting right now. And then moving forward with any kind of liquidated or adjudicated damages is obviously the purview that we have to, as a city and an administration and a council, be able to effectuate and move forward on, tangential to the current need of picking up the trash.
I'm talking about correct. The existing contracts. I'm not talking about the emergency situation.
I'm talking about the existing, too.
Because basically, if you can hold them accountable, there is a procedures of notification. So prior to Ida, did the city initiate, when we had all of these concerns, when trash was not being picked up prior to Ida, was there a notice to the to the trash contractor that they were in violation of the contract?
I will have to get back with you. That would be a question that I'd want directly responded to from either the sanitation department or the law department.
So that's my question. We knew we had an issue before, and so has the city not followed up and held the contractor accountable by what is, I'm looking right now at the contract, what we're supposed to be doing. So according to this contract, if we have unsatisfactory performance, we can go after damages. In order to start those damages, you have to have proof that there have been damages, so proof that there hasn't been picked up, which is why I asked about the third party. And then you have to have a notification to the contractor. So my big question is, if we knew going into Ida that we had issues with this contractor, did we notify the contractor formally as per this contract and then allow the contractor to then respond to that notification?
Sure, and I think there is a different level of performance output for the contractor pre-Ida and post-Ida. I think
That's why I'm talking about pre-Ida, but I think it shows that if we have not had a professional relationship, even from the city perspective, in terms of holding the contractor accountable and we haven't started that procedure, then of course we're going to be falling behind with Ida.
And
after Ida.
And I'd prefer to have the law and sanitation department speak directly.
Got it. I think that's fair. And then who then is, the questions I'm asking you should probably go to the person who's responsible for communicating complaints to Metro or to Richards or to Empire. So who would that be? Is that the city or is that the head of sanitation or is that legal?
The complaints should be going to sanitation. They have the direct.
And so the director of sanitation should be the one that starts this process of notification?
I think in conjunction with, I mean, the law department's going to lead the process, but it's the data received by the sanitation department that would provoke such a decision moving forward.
Okay. And what I did not see within these contracts were we've talked about and danced around the issues of labor shortages and pay. Is anything in these contracts state how hoppers should be paid or how drivers should be paid?
With the exception, to my understanding, of the living wage ordinance, no.
Right. And we did that after the fact, and we all know that these contracts were effectuated before this administration, so I also want to make that clear and be fair. So we don't have anything in here that shows how much each of these different contractors have been paying their employees.
Correct.
We do not know. And so does the city have any information on labor shortages different between each of the different vendors? Because that's been something that everyone's been talking about.
I defer to the vendors anecdotally. Yes, I think that, and I think even Mr. Woods highlighted that, but yes, there is a difference in labor shortage between the companies, but I don't want to speak for the companies.
Okay. And then just my last question is, has the city collected any penalties from Metro to date for unsatisfactory performance prior to Ida?
No. But I think that that's important to say and highlight is that does not mean that won't occur, right? I mean, but it's important to time this so that it's important that they have the opportunity to fulfill their obligations of picking up the trash before we get into the litigious nature of what the contracts does obligate the city to provide. So that is the reason for the no. If we stop paying them, they could potentially stop paying their drivers, and then we have no alternative to address the plaguing problem that we're discussing today.
And I absolutely agree with that, and no one's sitting here talking about litigious, but we are talking about a professional level of communication between the entities to hold, for that we each hold each other accountable to, and whether or not that's occurred. That makes sense?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Gilbert, I do want to see if we can get answered to the question about getting the communication right on the bags that are outside the cans and what people should do, et cetera, because I want to just make sure everybody understands. I'm getting that question a lot.
Yes, and I'm gonna speak a little bit from the cuff on this because it is a nuanced question. Operation Mardi Gras is intended to pick up all the trash outside of the can, and for the reasons that we specified related to the machine mechanism required to lift the heaviness of the can. 10 crews out this morning as of 7 or 8 this morning. Our goal within the 7 days is to pick up all the trash in Area 2, where the most need is required. Now, if we have to do other passes because more trash has gone on the outside to pick up because the residents can't put their trash inside, that is something that we have to do. So I'm saying there shouldn't be, although we're saying 7 days to accomplish this based on our assessment and a dashboard to require that, we're not going to stop till the work is done. So if bags keep going outside of the trash can and it's not keeping up with pace with their pickup schedule, that's what we're going to maintain doing. But tangentially, I also want to highlight, once we have that transfer station, I believe their productivity is going to increase significantly. Couple that with these 20 trash trucks we're working with in Florida to try to get drivers to come down with, coupled with other discussions that are ongoing that we're trying to effectuate in the near future as well that are not finalized yet, but we want to have in the next few days. All of those resources should have caught the city up. Where there shouldn't be, we hope, more trash going outside of the bins. But until that is solved, we'll keep picking it up outside, including Area 1 if that becomes a problem. But like I said, I don't think we've had any significant problems in Area 1. It's all been focused on Area 2.
Okay. And then the same thing for people. I know this is a silly nuance of that nuance question, but I've got a lot of people who said half my trash got picked up out of the can.
Do I tell them take it out of the can and put it all on the side, or do I tell them just leave it in the can and we're going to get to it in the next 7 days?
You know, I wouldn't even be so prescriptive necessarily. If their can's full, put your trash outside your can. The city will pick it up and we'll take it away. I mean, and we're going to maintain that until we are exhausted from the trash outside the can.
And just piggybacking, on that particular point, you know, we've received help from the sheriff's office, who's provided a garbage truck in Area 2. That particular truck that the sheriff's office is operating doesn't have the tippers on the back to tip the carts in. So they've been making the rounds, taking bags from around trash cans. And we've gotten a rash of calls saying, well, you picked up the bags, but not the cart. Well, the sheriff is assisting in that instance. So he's picking up strictly bags, and then we're following him with the regular garbage tipper. So some people will react and say, well, you just took a few bags, but not everything, you know. So it could be a little bit confusing, but I want to tip my hat to the sheriff for stepping in to try to help out in this matter as well.
I appreciate that, but I'm just trying to find some bright lines that we can tell residents about what they can expect. This is the other thing, like, we've all been sort of talking about it up here. You know, Gilbert, it really sounds like there are things that are being implemented as of today, and then there are more implementations that are going to happen over the next couple of days. I think what we would like to do, I know I have one more public comment card for somebody who's here, and then we'll do maybe 15 minutes of the public comment, is come back on Tuesday morning instead of when criminal justice is and get an update on how everything has proceeded. Because I think so much of this has been, we're in the process, we're getting close, this is where we are. So, I've asked a lot of questions about sort of when, and it sounds like the when is being delayed by we're doing the best that we can. We'd like to know more about that. I think also for the contractors, as Councilmember Palmer made this point, we're also getting a lot of questions about pay for hoppers and drivers. You all may want to publicize that. I mean, that would be my strong suggestion, is what hoppers and drivers are making per hour, because one of the contentions is if you all raised your wages and you would have more people. And so,
Councilman, I know that's out in the public sphere, but we pay drivers to start $17 an hour. That's extremely competitive with our peers in the market. We did that some months ago,
right?
Post-pandemic, of course, but certainly before Ida. And the hoppers are obviously required to get paid the city's living wage level, and we actually pay beyond that.
Yeah, so. I just, if the city is sort of saying money isn't an object and they're looking for other contractors, then raising labor rates may also yield results without using other contractors. So, all right. Then I have one public comment, and Ms. Gaynor, you have 2 minutes, ma'am, and then we'll go to the electronic comments for 15 minutes, and then we'll stand adjourned until 9:30 on Tuesday. Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning. My name is Ms. Gaynor. I'm in Area 2. I've heard the comments about Area 2 being picked up. Nothing has been picked up. Nothing has been picked up since the hurricane and even before the hurricane. So, Jared, thank you for, you know me personally, and I've been calling and calling even before Hurricane Ida hit the area. My thing is, I have allergies. I can't even go outside to even put out the trash. I'm hoarse right now because I'm coughing. The atmosphere is nasty, filthy. The trash, Metro, we're tired. All we need, somebody to pick up the trash, take our money from Metro, and let's get the job done for somebody who's willing and have the equipment to do what we need to do in our area. And that's all we're asking. For as Metro, with the prices, I've talked to several people who work for Metro. They say the facilities and the trucks are very filthy. Even before this, if everybody remember, Metro had a big strike saying how the facilities was dirty. The company didn't want to do anything to make it clean when they're driving the trucks. So, hey, if you don't have a clean area to work,
nobody's going to work, and they will go somewhere else. So my complaint is, Metro, we don't want you no more. Let's get somebody who could do the job, make us happy as citizens of New Orleans, pick up the trash on a regular, and get the filth and the dirt from our area. I have flies, bugs coming in a home. I've been bitten. I mean, really, it's ridiculous. And we're still paying money. There's other people out there saying, we'll do the job. But my money is all with Sewage and Water Board and locked up. I don't have money to pay somebody else to come pick up my trash and bring it. That's all I'm saying. Let's break the contract with Metro, find somebody else. It's just easy as that. We keep hanging on and hanging on to these people who are not fulfilling our needs. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you for your comments and for your patience, ma'am.
Thank you. And I guess also I spoke with some of my colleagues. We'll try and also have somebody from FEMA and DEQ here to answer questions on Tuesday, too. So that way, in case anything comes up, Stafford Act, non-Stafford Act, FEMA reimbursable, can DEQ do this, then we'll be in a good spot to help answer all those things. Particularly, and Gilbert, you asked for our help, so we want to make sure that we're part of the solution, too. And if there's things about contacting national contractors, other contractors, getting more relief, we want to help with all of that because it's all of our problem. We want to help solve it.
Joe?
Yes, Councilmember Banks.
Gilbert, do you think by Tuesday we would have a clearer picture on the possible additional emergency transfer stations that were talked about? That those are two areas that Mr. Woods mentioned. Do you think we could have additional information about that to see if we can stand those up? And
I mean, I'll answer yes, but I haven't been updated by the team working on it because I've been up here. So I would assume yes. I was told 2 or 3 days to finalize that, but I haven't been able to check in with the group as a result of being
if
here.
If you could try to prioritize that, because that'll help us again. This elephant is too big to eat all at once. So if we get one bite at a time, we're doing much better. So if you could put that on your list for Tuesday, I'd appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank
all
you.
Right, we'll do public comments for 15 minutes. It's 12:31, and each comment will have 2 minutes. Thank you.
William Cruikshank, the 6900 blocks of Louisville and Colbert that share the service alley have only had one trash pickup in the last 6 weeks due to road construction taking place on Walker and Mouton Streets. One resident chased down an Ivy waste garbage truck to plead for the driver to try to enter our alley from Mouton. It was extremely difficult for the driver to do so, but she managed. She then stated, they will not enter our alley again until they are more accessible due to the difficulty. Please provide guidance to the sanitation workers and residents on how to remedy this situation. Our section of Lakeview has not had trash pickup since before Ida, where the service alleys are accessible. Also, the sanitation workers will not be driving down Colbert because it is currently a dead end due to the construction on Walker Street. If residents place their garbage curbside, the sanitation workers would not know to pick up this trash if not instructed by the city, and they might likely just drive by it on Louisville if not instructed to look out for the cans being placed curbside. If you'd like a picture of the garbage piling up, please reach out to me via email, and I can provide them to you. Thank you for taking time to address this specific issue. Aloma Likes. My garbage and recycling in Oak Park Gentilly have not been collected since August 21st, 2021. This is unacceptable. I hope the situation can be rectified soon. Now the post-Hurricane Ida garbage has been added, which has made the situation worse. Yvette Taylor. The New Orleans citywide garbage collection and sanitation services are deplorable and unacceptable. It is my understanding that these services have been privatized by Richards Disposal Company and Metro Disposal and Sanitation Company, although these services are listed under Department of Sanitation. Since the privatization of these very necessary services, the garbage and trash collection for the entire Orleans Parish has been unacceptable and putting our communities and neighborhoods at risk for habitation of rodents, disease-causing insects, airborne bacteria and pathogens, environmental demise, ecological deterrence. It's my attitude that the privatized companies who obtained the responsibility of the very necessary service of garbage collection and sanitation should have had everything in place that is needed to run a business of garbage and trash collection and sanitation. They should be well equipped with the mechanics and automation for the disposal trucks to function properly. They should be able to provide employees with a very good salary that is commendable for someone performing such necessary services. They should be prepared to provide the employees with protective clothing necessary to prevent the employees from contracting diseases and getting ill due to the nature of the job. I also feel that these private companies should be fined and fired for not providing the necessary services as they agreed to when they decided to bid and apply for the necessary services of garbage collection and sanitation. This service should not have been looked at as a business venture and a personal business capitalization for Richards Disposal and Metro Disposal Companies as a service that the two companies desired to provide for our city of New Orleans. We look like a third world country with all the garbage and trash and debris in all the communities and neighborhoods around our great city of New Orleans. Janelle Hazlett, I'm a Richards trash recycling collection customer. The first day of trash collection on my street post Ida was 9/14/21. Richards has occasionally missed pickups on our street in the past, but for the most part, service has been very consistent. For future trash collection budgeting and planning, I would suggest that given the size of the cans used for garbage and recycling, it might be possible to go down to once a week pickups for garbage and twice a month pickups for recycling. Any contract needs to include a way for citizens to call in large debris piles that result from dumping and have these picked up by 311 requests. Large piles lead to larger piles. I'd also like to see something in the contracts which allow or a tire team to deal specifically with pickup and, if possible, recycling of tires. Tire piles are all over the city and are very difficult to get removed. Tire piles grow more tires. Yvette Taylor, on behalf of Lavender Street Community and Neighborhood. In addendum to my previous comment, the necessary City of New Orleans service of garbage and trash collection and sanitation, Sewerage and Water Board, Police and Fire Department should never be privatized. These are essential services to the citizens of the city and also most important and necessary services that keep the city functioning and safe, free from haphazardness. James Segretto, my only comment is that if you stayed through the hurricane and proceeded to remove debris immediately afterwards, you were guided by statements by DPW and sanitation to put debris on the curb without distinctions regarding content. This I completed by Thursday of the same week. Subsequent announcements were issued that stated that the debris should be sorted. I had to sort out the pile then. Should be made clear at the outset. Bill Glue. No trash, recycling, or storm debris pickup on my block since before Ida. Cans are heavy because they contain 3 weeks plus worth. Failure to collect waste is evidence of failed government. Please help. John Johnson. Can the city hire Ivy Trash Collection to supplement the current trash collection contracts since they seem to have the capacity? John Johnson. My recycling has been on the street next to the trash can. My trash was picked up once, but I have a lot more recycling than trash. Now the recycling items are getting so dirty that it is becoming trash. When will recycling be back? Brandon Scott. I live at 4628 Frenchman Street in Gentilly. Both trash pickup and recycling on my street were missed over an entire week prior to Hurricane Ida making landfall. I reached out to my council member's office and was told that my route was completed on Sunday 9/12, which is outright false. We are now closing in on 4 weeks since a truck passed on my street. Our street smells awful and we're absolutely disgusted. We are fed up with Metro Disposal, but also with the blatant miscommunication from your offices. Megan Founce. Metro has been a horrible company for as long as I can remember. They refuse to pay their employees a respectable and livable wage for what is one of the most critical services a person can perform in a city. They don't keep to schedule and constantly make excuses. Their They are being paid to not do their job, and that pay is obviously not making it to the employees. My block hasn't had trash pickup in over a month. That's 2 weeks before Ida that we missed pickups. It's disgusting. This is not an Ida issue. For the past year, we might have trash pickup twice a month rather than two times a week, and we never know when it will happen, certainly not Monday and Thursday. The number of times I've had to wash out my rancid, maggot-filled trash can this summer is out of control. Trash collection should not be contracted out, let alone to incompetent and corrupt companies. The city should have their own trash collection system that officials have full and total control over. Daniel Rutsch. I request that the $24 sanitation fee be refunded going back at least 2 months and removed from our sewage and water board bills for as long as sanitation collection is not consistently occurring. This fee is assessed for twice weekly garbage pickup and once weekly recycling pickup. My garbage has been picked up once in the last 5 weeks. My recycling has been picked up twice in the last 12 weeks. This issue predates Hurricane Ida. I'm understanding of the effects that the storm had on the city's and its contractors' ability to execute sanitation pickup. That said, it's unconscionable to continue to charge the residents of the city for a service we are not receiving when we're all hurting. Charles Shelley, the city has enforcement mechanisms to ensure basic compliance by waste contractors. Despite this, Mr. Woods of Metro has been able to aggrandize himself by balking at any semblance of good labor practices, failing to provide adequate pay, PPE, or staffing, and even for a long time ignoring all collective bargaining efforts. It has been weeks since our trash has been collected. People look at this failure to provide basic services when they decide whether or not they'll return home after the hurricane, or whether their temporary home, which probably collects trash on time, should become their permanent home. In that sense, holding sanitation contractors accountable for negative sanctions should be a matter of public policy. Mr. Woods has a mansion right on Bayou St. John. He can afford it. The city of New Orleans, on the other hand, can't afford to look away while this fundamental facet of municipal government is stripped away. David Broussard, if the trash is not being picked up, who's being paid and why is that money being kept if we are not getting a service? Ron Brody, I believe at this point fines should be levied against the sanitation companies. Linda Anderson, I want to know why our contractor pays their employees so little and if they contributed personally or professionally to the mayor's campaign. Garbage collection is also part of our city's overall health. Why is she not screaming from the rooftops about this like she continues to do regarding COVID? Where are the fines to our trash collection services for this debacle? Did they attempt to help their employees mitigate their personal Ida situation so they could return to work? Why was the dump not open sooner to residents? Now garbage is so high in some neighborhoods, they'd have to hire their own garbage truck. The excuses are feeble. Todd Yannaconi. There hasn't been trash collection in a vast majority of the city in weeks, since before Ida even hit. There is a foul stench around every corner of the city. I live in a major street, St. Claude, and we haven't had any pickup of trash or debris that I have noticed anywhere near where I live. And yet, we still have bills coming in charging us for the services of picking up trash, despite those services not being rendered. We shouldn't be charged for trash pickup if the trash isn't being picked up, plain and simple. It's unethical and immoral for anything other than that. Please make sure we get reimbursed for bills we've been paying, and please start to actually pick up the trash sometime soon. Laura Guccione. My trash pickup has been spotty since the summer started. My block had no pickup 2 weeks before the storm and still no trash pickup since. I've called 311 weekly and usually the trash would get picked up, but not the week before Ida. I was drafting a letter to the city council and the mayor the day I had to evacuate, so I feel like this might be an ongoing problem and unfortunately not relate to the weather. I guess now that everyone is dealing with a lack of sanitation, out gets noticed. Charles Steiner. As of today, 9/15/21, there has been zero trash collection in the entire Marigny Bywater area since Ida. Before the storm, Metro missed 5 weeks of trash and recycling pickups. Metro has proved itself incompetent to carry out its contract, so I propose that all payments to Metro be immediately withheld and its contract terminated. Jean Valier. Metro in my neighborhood had been problematic long before Ida. They consistently missed pickups, have trucks that leak, and are being paid a lot of money to do for a job that is being poorly done. I fail to understand why the city does not void the contract with this company. It seems our mayor, who I think has been great with COVID, makes excuses for this company. This contractor is substandard. What is wrong with our leadership? Lisa Tenenbaum. Per Section 138-1 of the City of New Orleans Municipal Code, the city shall be responsible for providing adequate solid waste management and disposal facilities. The city has been woefully deficient in this action, even prior to Ida. And I hope, per item 2 on this agenda, that FEMA doesn't pay for much because the city has also been derelict in enforcing its own solid waste contracts in order to ensure proper trash pickup and provide for health, safety, and welfare of the citizens here prior to the hurricane. This isn't, amazingly, and something I will rarely say, the federal government's mess to clean up. It's yours. Presumably, there's an agreement with the city's solid waste providers, though a search of city archives and agendas made it so that I was unable to locate the terms of that agreement. I'd hate to think that was by design. However, if anyone competent wrote that agreement, it should have liquidated damages and failure to perform clauses that the city should be enforcing, and it needs to enforce them. The duty of this body and all boards and bodies of the city is not to city government or city contractors, but to the citizens of this community, and we are failing them and your fiduciary duty to them. I say that as a former assistant city attorney for another jurisdiction who has written and enforced solid waste agreements, if the city's agreement does not contain enforcement provisions or other enforceable provisions up to and including a termination clause to ensure the adequate removal of waste for the municipality, the city council should direct staff and the city attorney to rewrite those agreements immediately and to bring in new solid waste providers if the job is too much for current providers, which it appears it is. This is abhorrent. This is a behavior of a non-functioning society. We are having impacts on health, safety, and welfare, as we saw when we couldn't use the neutral ground for parking when we felt the effects of the most recent storm. Are you waiting for this to turn into a tragedy before you force performance and also enact a living wage ordinance so the men and women laboring to do this incredibly difficult and undesirable work are fairly compensated? I love this city. Do better.
Thank you. I think that concludes our 15 minutes. Thank you for reading all those. If anybody's watching, we will put all 166 or plus comments into the public record. Thank you all for being here today. We look forward to getting more answers and seeing where the solutions are. We will stand at ease until Tuesday. Did we sign at 9:30 or 10? 9:30. Tuesday at 9:30, we'll come back. So with that, this meeting is ended for today. Thank you very much. Hope everybody has a good weekend.
Now that the meeting's adjourned, I just have one quick thing to say, and that's a happy birthday to Madam Vice.